Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, we will bring today's program with a recitation of the Quran by Brother Farik Zakir Naik.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن تطيعوا فريقا من الذين أوتوا الكتاب يردوكم بعد إيمانكم كافرين وكيف تكفرون وأنتم تتلى عليكم آيات الله وفيكم رسوله ومن يعتصم بالله فقد هدي إلى صراط مستقيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم منها كذلك يبين الله لكم آياته لعلكم تهتدون ولتكن منكم أمة يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر وأولئك هم المفلحون صدق الله العظيم.
The translation of the verses that Brother Farik just recited, which are from Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verses 102 to 104. O you who believed, fear Allah as He should be feared, and do not die except as Muslims in submission to Him. And hold firmly to the rope of Allah altogether, and do not become divided. And remember the favor of Allah upon you when you were enemies and He brought your hearts together. And you became by His favor brothers, and you were on the edge of a pit of the fire, and He saved you from it. Thus does Allah make clear to you His verses that you may be guided. And let there be arising from you a nation, inviting to all that is good, enjoining all that is right, and forbidding what is wrong, and those will be the successful. Now, I would like to invite Brother Arif Julfar, the member of organizing committee, head of the program of activities unit, Dubai Holy Quran Award, organizers of tonight's program, to kindly come on stage and address the audience.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. First thing, Ramadan Mubarak to all of you. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. We thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for achieving the month of Ramadan. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lead us to His best way and accept our good deeds. Tonight, we are receiving one of the most glorious speakers in the world, Dr. Zakir Naik. Dr. Zakir, mashallah, has been doing da'wah work. He left his area of specialties, which was medicine doctor, for the work of da'wah and the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dubai International Holy Quran Award was insisting to receive Dr. Zakir in this session, which is number 13. And alhamdulillah, we received him a couple times during the previous years. Dr. Zakir, mashallah, he knows not only Islam, but also knows very well all about the other religions. So he can talk what are mainly the similarities in the beginning between Islam, which is his religion, and other religions, Hinduism, Christianism, Judaism, and so on. So this is one of the things that made our organizing committee in Dubai International Holy Quran Award to invite Dr. Zakir to deliver his speech today and tomorrow in the same place, inshallah ta'ala. I really thank, first thing, Dr. Zakir for being here tonight. We really thank his team. I don't want to mention some of their names, so I will not forget others, for working day and night to getting this place and this event be ready for this moment. But just I will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward them the best. Finally, I thank all of you for being here tonight, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give mercy to all of you and to all of those who are watching. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Before I call upon you, Dr. Zakir Naik, I would like to give his brief introduction. Dr. Zakir Naik, a medical doctor by professional training, is renowned as a dynamic international orator on Islam and comparative religion. Dr. Zakir Naik is the president of Islamic Research Foundation, Mumbai. Dr. Zakir Naik clarifies Islamic viewpoints and clears misconceptions about Islam using the Quran, authentic hadith, and other religious scriptures as a basis in conjunction with reason, logic, and scientific facts. He is 43 years old. He is popular for his critical analysis and convincing answers to challenging questions posed by audiences after his public talks. In the last 12 years, by the year 2008, Dr. Zakir Naik has delivered more than 1,200 public talks in the USA, Canada, UK, Italy, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Kuwait, Qatar, Bahrain, Oman, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, Botswana, Malaysia, Hong Kong, Thailand, Guyana, South America, Trinidad, and many other countries, in addition to numerous public talks in India. He has successfully participated in several symposia and dialogues with prominent personalities of other faiths. His public dialogue with Dr. William Campbell of the USA on the topic, The Quran and the Bible in the Light of Science, held in Chicago, USA on April 2000, was a resounding success. His interfaith dialogue with prominent Hindu guru Sri Sri Ravi Shankar on the topic, The Concept of God in Hinduism and Islam in the Light of the Sacred Scriptures, held at Palace Grounds, Bangalore, on 21st Jan 2006, was highly appreciated by people of both the faiths. In the issue dated 22nd Feb 2009 of the Indian Express, list of the 100 most powerful Indians in 2009, amongst the billion plus population of India, Dr. Zakir Naik was ranked number 82 in the special list of the top 10 spiritual gurus of India. Dr. Zakir Naik was ranked number 3 after Baba Ramdev and Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, being the only Muslim in the list. Dr. Zakir Naik stood out most eloquently for Islam and Muslims in the present times on one of the leading and most respected news channels of India, NDTV 24/7, during the Guest This Week interview program Walk the Talk, conducted by host Shikhar Gupta, editor-in-chief of Indian Express, telecast on 7th and 8th March 2009. Sheikh Ahmed Didat, the world-famous orator on Islam and comparative religion, who called Dr. Zakir Didat Plus in 1994, presented a plaque in May 2000 with an engraving awarded to Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik for his achievement in the field of Dawah and the study of comparative religion. Son, what you have done in 4 years had taken me 40 years to accomplish, alhamdulillah. Dr. Zakir Naik appears regularly on many international TV channels in more than 200 countries of the world. He is regularly invited for TV and radio interviews. More than 100 of his talks, dialogues, debates and symposia are available on DVDs and VCDs. He has authored many books on Islam and comparative religion. Brothers and sisters, please welcome Dr. Zakir Naik.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala ali wa sahbi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin nas. Ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar wa tu'minuna billah. Kul in kana aba'ukum wa abna'ukum wa ikhwanukum wa azwajukum wa ashiratukum wa amwalun iqtaraftumuha wa tidarajun takshawna qasadaha ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله فتربصوا حتى يأتي الله بأمري والله لا يهلككم الفاسقين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي My respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. It's an honor for me to be invited for the third time by the Dubai International Holy Quran Award, organized by the Dubai government under the patronage of Sheikh Mohammed Rashid Al Maktoum, the Vice President and Prime Minister of UAE and the ruler of Dubai. And it's a pleasure for me to address the audience of Dubai after a gap of 4 years. And I remember the last I'd addressed the audience of Dubai was in 2005, Ramadan, again organized by the Dubai International Holy Quran Award. And it was just before we launched our satellite channel, that's the Peace TV, just about 2 months before we launched our satellite channel. And alhamdulillah, by Allah's grace, the Peace TV in the span of 3.5 years has become the most popular and the most watched Islamic satellite channel in the world. Not only has it become the most watched Islamic channel, but in the last few months, it has become the most popular watched religious channel in the world. Alhamdulillah. And today, the estimated viewership of Peace TV is, alhamdulillah, more than 100 million people throughout the world. And you'll be happy to know, 2 months ago, we launched a second channel. Previously in the Peace TV, we had 75% English and 25% Urdu. The people who didn't know English used to complain that why is Urdu so less? And in the Western world, those who didn't understand Urdu, Hindi used to say, what is this in between Urdu and Hindi programs coming? So to satisfy both the people, 2 months back, we launched a second satellite channel, which is called as the Peace TV Urdu. So I think that whenever the Dubai International Holy Quran Award calls me, I think it's linked with the launch of a satellite channel. And you'll be happy to know that both these channels are, alhamdulillah, uplinked from the Dubai Media City. The uplink from Dubai Media City is on the Inter side and Arab side, covering Asia, Middle East, Africa, Australia. And from London, we uplink and cover Europe and North and South America. So I would like to thank the Dubai Holy Quran Award for calling me, and for even Dubai government for giving the facility for uplinking both these satellite channels. The topic of this evening's talk is Dawah or Destruction. What is the meaning of the word Dawah? Those of us, especially people coming from the Indian subcontinent who speak Hindi and Urdu, they know the meaning of the word Dawat. And the moment we hear the word Dawat, we start thinking of chicken biryani or mutton biryani. In other words, we're having a party. Dawah or Dawat actually means an invitation. Dawah means to call. Today, we will not be speaking about an invitation to a lunch or a dinner party. Today, we'll be speaking about Da'wat al-Islam, an invitation, a call to Islam. And an invitation is not given to the own family members. Normally, an invitation is given to an outsider. Similarly, Da'wat al-Islam is mainly an invitation, a call to the non-Muslims. Whenever we speak about Islam to a non-Muslim, trying to clarify the misconception, trying to make him understand Islam better, to remove the negative idea that he has about Islam, it is called as Dawah. Many a time, Dawah is also used synonymously when we speak about Islam to a Muslim. But the more appropriate Arabic word, when we speak about Islam to a Muslim, it is Islah. Islah in Arabic means to repair. It means to improve. So when a Muslim speaks to another Muslim, giving him more information about Islam, the more appropriate word is Islah. And when we speak to the non-Muslims, talking about Islam, the more appropriate word is Dawah. So today, we'll be discussing Dawah or destruction. The Muslims should convey the message of Islam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the non-Muslims, otherwise they will be destroyed. I started my talk by quoting a verse from the glorious Quran, from Surah Al Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 110, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kuntum khaira ummatin ukhrijat linnas. O ye people, O ye Muslims, ye are the best of peoples evolved for mankind. Ye Muslims are the best of peoples evolved for mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us Muslims as the khaira ummah. Allah is giving us that honor. Whenever an honor is given, it is always followed up with responsibility. There is no honor without responsibility. For example, in a school, the principal has got more honor than a teacher. A teacher has got more honor than a clerk. Similarly, the principal has got more responsibility than a teacher. A teacher has got more responsibility than a clerk. There is no honor without responsibility. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the glorious Quran is calling us Muslim as a khaira ummah. He's calling us as the best of people. Don't you think we have a responsibility? The reply is given in the same verse. Allah continues and says, تَأْمِرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. Because you enjoin what is good and you forbid what is wrong and you believe in Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us Muslim as a khaira ummah because we enjoin what is good and we forbid what is wrong and we believe in Allah. If we do not enjoin what is good and if we do not forbid what is wrong, we aren't fit to be called as khaira ummah. We aren't fit to be called as Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us this honor, calls us Muslims the khaira ummah, the best of people, because we enjoin what is good and we forbid what is wrong and we believe in Allah. If we do not convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the non-Muslims and remove the misconceptions that is there in their minds, we aren't fit to be called as khaira ummah. We aren't fit to be called as Muslims. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 143, that we have made you an ummat-e wasat, a middlemost community, a justly balanced community, so that you may be a witness over the nations and the messenger will be a witness over you. Allah has made us Muslims as an ummat-e wasat, a middlemost community, a justly balanced community, so that we convey the message, we bear witness to the others, to the other people in humanity, and our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will bear witness over us. In the beginning of my speech, I also quoted a verse of the Quran from Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 24. Surah Tawbah happens to be the most militant surah in the glorious Quran. If you read the Quran, the most militant surah in the complete Quran is Surah Tawbah. Why do I say that Surah Tawbah is the most militant surah in the Quran? Because Surah Tawbah is the only surah in the glorious Quran which does not begin with the beautiful formula Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Every surah, every chapter of the glorious Quran begins with the beautiful formula Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Except Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9. If you read Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul huwa Allahu ahad. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Says Allah one and only. Surah Falaq, chapter number 113. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq. Say, I seek refuge with the Lord of Dawn. Surah Nas, chapter number 114. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Say, I seek refuge with Allah, who is the Lord of the humankind. Every chapter begins with the beautiful formula, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. But in the beginning of Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, there is no Bismillah. Why? For example, if you are walking down the streets of Dubai, maybe on Dubai Corniche, along with your wife, or along with your mother, and suppose there is a hooligan who snatches the handbag of your wife or of your mother and he runs away. What will you do? But naturally follow. And the moment you catch up with him, you will not say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, may peace be on you. You will not say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. The moment you catch up with him, you will get down to the subject directly. Hey mister, give the handbag, I'll break your neck. Hey mister, give the handbag, I'll break your arm. You will get down to the subject directly. Bismillah is uncalled for. Similarly, if you read Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, if you read the few verses in the beginning, there was a peace treaty between the Muslims and the mushriks of Makkah. And this peace treaty was unilaterally broken by the mushriks of Makkah. By the time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reaches verse number 5, Surah Tawbah chapter number 9, he is giving a warning. He is giving an ultimatum to the mushriks of Makkah. You put things straight in 4 months' time, otherwise there is a declaration of war. When Allah is giving an ultimatum, is giving a warning, he gets down to the subject directly. Though there are many reasons why Bismillah is not there in Surah Tawbah, but some of the Mufassireen, they say that because Allah is giving a warning directly to the mushriks of Makkah, Bismillah is uncalled for. He gets down to the subject directly. But by the time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reaches verse number 24, now he is addressing us Muslims. Now we Muslims are in the firing line. And Allah says, Kul, say, in kana abaukum, whether it be for your fathers, wa abnaukum, or your sons, wa ikhwanukum, or your brothers, wa azwajukum, or your spouses, your wives or husbands, wa ashiratukum, or your relatives. Allah is asking, what are your considerations? Are they your fathers? Are they your sons? Are they your spouses, your wives or husbands? Are they your relatives? And Allah continues, wa amwalun ikhtaraftumuha wa tidaratum taksawna qasadaha wa masakinu tawzawnaha. The wealth that you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the houses in which you live. Allah is asking, what are your considerations? Are they your fathers? Are they your sons? Are they your brothers? Are they your spouses? Are they your relatives? The wealth you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the houses in which you live. Some people may be worried that, you know, what will my father say? What will my son say? What will my brother say? My spouses or my relatives? There'll be a loss in my business. Maybe the wealth I've amassed, I will lose it. The house that I live in, there may be danger to it. And Allah continues, Ahabba ilaykum minallahi wa rasulihi wa jihadin fi sabilihi. If you love all these things more than Allah, His Rasul, and doing jihad in the way of Allah. Allah says, if you love all these 8 things, your fathers, your sons, your brothers, your spouses, your wives and husbands, your relatives, the business in which you deal, the wealth that you have amassed, the house in which you live, if you love all these 8 things more than Allah, His Messenger, His Rasul, and doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, Fatarabbasu, wait. Hatta yati Allahu bi amri, until Allah brings about His decision unto you. Hatta yati Allahu bi amri, until Allah brings about His destruction unto you. Wallahu la yahdikum al-fasiqin, and Allah guides not the fasik people. Allah is telling in this verse of the Quran of Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, verse number 24, that if you love your father, your sons, your brothers, your spouses, your relatives, the wealth you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the houses in which you live, if you love all these 8 things more than Allah, more than His Rasul, His Messenger, and doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And jihad fi sabilillah is of various types. And today, the best jihad, according to me, is conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is dawah. Conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the non-Muslims. Removing the misconception from their minds. If you love all these 8 things more than Allah, His Rasul, and doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, wait. What does Allah mean when He says, wait? And we Muslims are waiting, sitting on our backside doing nothing. What does Allah mean when He says, wait? For example, if in a school, there is a senior student who's bullying the junior student. And the junior student tells the senior student, wait till I get my elder brother. And his elder brother happens to be the biggest hooligan in that area. When the junior student is telling the senior student, wait, what he's actually telling him is that you buzz off. You vanish. You better improve. Otherwise, you'll be taught a lesson. So similarly, Allah says, Fatarabbasu, wait. He's telling us Muslims, wait. Wait doesn't mean, and we Muslims are waiting, sitting on our backside doing nothing. What does Allah mean when He says, wait? He's telling you, you buzz off. You better improve. Fatarabbasu, hatta ya'ti Allahu al-yamri, wallahu al-azimu al-fasikin. Wait until Allah brings His destruction unto you. And Allah guides not the fasik people. Imagine Allah is comparing these 8 things with the love of Allah, His Rasul, and doing jihad in His way. The first He says is whether it be for your fathers. And you know that in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after believing in Allah, the next thing Allah says is you have to be kind to your parents. Allah says in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 23 and 24, that He has ordained for you that you worship none but Him. And that you be kind to your parents. And if one or both of them reach old age, don't say a word of contempt. Don't say oof to them. Rather, address them with honor and speak with them with respect and lower to them your wing of humility and pray to the Lord that cherish them, bless them as they cherished me in childhood. Now Allah is comparing your parents, whether it be for parents, in terms of love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your parents, your sons, your spouses, your relatives, your brothers. And then He says, the wealth you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the house in which you live. That means the wealth that you have amassed, if you do not spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah says, wait, fatarabbas. And Allah gives an example, a beautiful example in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 261. Allah says that if you spend your wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is like a grain of corn, which grows into 7 ears, each year bearing 100 grains. That means Allah says, if you sow one grain of corn in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will give you 7 spikes, 7 years, each bearing 100 grains. That means if you give one, Allah will give you 700 times. In business terminology, it is called as 70,000%. And I'm talking about business because I know that the world is hit with recession, and especially Dubai. So if you want a business in which you will never lose, it is business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, in these times of turmoil, ups and downs, markets go up, markets come down, the business in which you'll never lose is business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah promises you 700 times return, 70,000% return. 70,000. The market in Dubai was good. In 1 year, you're getting 50% profit, 100% profit, real estate, 200% profit. Everyone goes into it. When Allah is telling 70,000% profit, no one is going for Allah's way. Why? We say we believe in Allah. 70,000% Allah promised. And Allah doesn't stop there. He continues. And Allah will give you many fold more. So Allah is comparing all these 8 things which you love. Your fathers, your sons, your brothers, your husbands and wives, your relatives, the wealth you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the house in which you live. Allah is saying, if you love all these things more than Allah, His Rasul, and doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, فَتَرَبَّصُ wait, حَتَّى يَأْتِ اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِي, until Allah brings about His destruction to you. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ الْفَاسِقِينَ, and Allah guides not the fasik people. Allah says in Surah Muhammad, chapter number 47, verse number 38, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ. If you do not do your job, if you turn away from Allah's path, Allah will substitute in your place another people. ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, and they will not be like you. Allah tells in the Quran in Surah Muhammad, chapter number 47, verse number 38, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا, if you do not do your job, if you turn away from Allah's path, يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ, Allah will substitute in your place another people, ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, and they will not be like you. And this example we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first chose the Jews to deliver His message. They were the chosen people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they were very proud. They did not follow Allah's commandments. If you read the Quran, more than 75% of the messengers of the prophets mentioned in the Quran, they are Jews. Majority. The Jews, they were the chosen people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they did not follow Allah's commandments. Allah gives the example in Surah Jummah, chapter number 62, verse number 5, that the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Mosaic law, was given to the Jews. But they did not do the obligations. The example, the similitude is that like donkeys, on whose back is tomes, tons of books, and they understand it not. The Jews were the chosen people, but they did not follow the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did not follow the message. So Allah gives the similitude that they are like donkeys on whose backs is tomes, tons of books, and they understand it not. And the same message is given in the Bible. If you read the Bible in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 21, verse number 43, it says that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to those nations who shall bear fruit of it. That means if you do not follow Allah's commandments, if you do not follow the commandment of God, in Gospel of Matthew chapter 21 verse 43, it says that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to the nation who shall bear fruit thereof. And we have these examples. The Jews, they were proud. They said, we are the chosen people. And Allah has His own way. If you do not follow Allah's commandments, what He does, the people you look down upon, He brings them from the dirt and makes them to sit on your head. And the Jews, they looked down upon the Arabs. 14 years back, the Arabs were looked down upon the Jews. And those days, it was called as Jamil Jahiliyah, the days of the ignorance. The Arabs were the ignorant people that time. And they were so ignorant that they did the tawaf around the Kaaba naked. They had a philosophy. How can we present ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better than the way we came in this world? So they did the tawaf around the Kaaba naked. They were that ignorant. What does Allah do? If you do not follow His commandment, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ, Allah will substitute a place another people, ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, and they will not be like you. So Allah brings these Arabs, and through the revelation of the glorious Quran, He makes these Arabs, who were called the most ignorant people, as the torch bearers of the world. He makes the people you look down upon to sit on your head. And we find that after the revelation of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the Arabs as the most enlightened people. But we should not be proud like the Jews. If we start being proud like the Jews, Allah says, يَسْتَبْدُلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, if you do not do your job, if you do not follow the commandment, Allah will substitute in your place another people. ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, and they will not be like you. And we have the example in Spain. We Muslims, we ruled Spain for about 800 years. But we did not convey the message. We did not give dawah. What does Allah do? Allah wipes out the Muslims. There was not a single Muslim who could openly give the azan in Spain. The crusaders came and they wiped out the Muslims. We did not do the job. We didn't convey a message. So now Allah is giving us a warning. And we see the ups and downs in history, that if we do not do the job, if we do not convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah is giving us hidayah to the non-Muslims, Allah will substitute in your place another people, summa lakin amsalukum, and they will not be like you. MashaAllah. Whenever you ask this question, and I like to ask this question to the Muslims here, that who do you love the most in this world? Who do you love the most in this world? Allah, mashallah. 100% correct. There is no price for that. Simple question, simple answer. When you ask any Muslim, who do you love the most? His answer would be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You ask any Muslim from any part of the world, who do you love the most? His answer would be Allah. Do we love Allah more than our mother? Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes, mashallah. Do you love Allah more than your father? Yes. Do you love Allah more than your sons? Yes. Do you love Allah more than your wife? More than your husband? More than your husband? You ask any Muslim, and the answer would be the same. We love Allah the most in the world. We love Allah more than our mother, more than our father, more than our sons, more than our wives, more than our husband. The answer is the same. We say it, wallah. But do we actually mean it? I'd like to ask you a simple question again. That suppose, one day in the morning, you leave your house and go to office for work. And when you're away from home, your neighbor, he abuses your mother. He uses foul language against your mother. When you come back home, and when you come to know that your neighbor has abused your mother, verbal abuse, has used foul language against your mother, what will you do? What will you do? What will you do? Panjim, what will you do? Kill him! MashaAllah. One person wants to punch him, one person wants to hit him, one person wants to kill him. See, I do agree, we love our mother. If anyone abuses a mother unnecessarily, without any rhyme or reason, uses foul language against a mother, I do agree, someone would like to hit him, someone would like to punch him, someone would like to kill him. It is human nature. Why? Because we love our mother. How dare someone abuses my mother? And believe me, if you cannot do it yourself, what will you do? You will hire someone else to do the job, but you will teach him a lesson. Yes or no? Yes. Why? Because we love our mother. If someone abuses a mother, he uses foul language against your mother, you will teach him a lesson. Either you'll punch him or you'll hit him. If you cannot do it yourself, you will hire someone else to do the job, but you'll teach him a lesson. Yes or no? Yes, mashallah. Why? Because we love our mother. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Maryam, chapter number 19, verse number 88 to 90, Allah says, وَقَالُوا اتَّقَذُوا الرَّحْمَانُ وَلَدَا. They say that Allah most gracious has begotten a son. لَقَدْ جِيْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا. Indeed, they have put forth a thing most monstrous. If anyone says that Allah has begotten a son, it is the biggest abuse you can give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is crying in the Quran that if anyone says Allah has begotten a son, it is the most heinous sin you can do. وَقَالُوا اتَّقَذُوا الرَّحْمَانُ وَلَدَا لَقَدْ جِيْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا تَقَادُوا السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَتَّرْنَا مِنُّ. If the sky had feelings, the sky would have burst open. وَتَنْشَقُ الْأَرْضُ. The earth would have split open. وَتَقْرُ الْجِبَالُ حَدَّا. And the mountains would have fallen down to utter ruin. Allah says that if the sky had feelings, and if someone would have said that Allah has begotten a son, the sky would have burst open, the earth would have split open, and the mountains would have fallen to utter ruin. But to us Muslims, believe me, it makes no difference. Every day, our non-Muslim friends, our non-Muslim colleagues, our non-Muslim neighbors, they are abusing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are saying that Allah has begotten a son, and we Muslims, we can't even open our mouth. We say we love Allah more than our mother, more than our father, more than our wife. We say it, but do we mean it? Every day. You go to school, you go to colleges, you go to universities, you go to place of work, you go to your offices. Every day, our non-Muslim brothers, our Hindu brothers and sisters, our Christian brothers and sisters, they are saying that Allah has begotten a son and we can't even open our mouth. We say we love Allah more than our mothers, more than our fathers. Someone wants to abuse your mother, you want to punch him, you want to hit him, you want to kill him. Every day, our non-Muslim colleagues, our non-Muslim friends, they're abusing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are saying that Allah has begotten a son and we can't even open our mouth. I'm not telling that you should punch him. I'm not telling that you should hit him. I'm not saying that you should fight him. I'm not saying that you should kill him. At least open your mouth. When you say you love Allah more than your mother, more than your father, someone abuses a mother, you want to hire someone else to do the job. When they're abusing our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't fight them, don't hit them. At least open your mouth. Every day. Leave aside opening our mouth. We are afraid to even talk to them. All of us Muslims know very well. When we go for parties, if we go to a party called by a Hindu friend, and if he's having some puja, or gives a prasad, you know, prasad means the food they give to the deity, to the idol. If they offer to the Muslim, almost all the Muslims know that eating prasad is haram. Why? Allah says in no less than four different places. In Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 173. In Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 3. In Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 145. And Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 115. Hurrimat alaykumul maytutu waddamu walahmul khinzir. Wama uhilla li ghayril labi. Forbidden for you for food, dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah's name is taken. All of us Muslims know very well that to eat the food on which any name besides Allah's name is taken, it is a sin. But when the Hindus offer you prasad, you feel bad to refuse it. So what do? You say Bismillah and have it. Tomorrow, you'll say Bismillah and have alcohol. Day after tomorrow, you'll say Bismillah and have pork. What's happened to the Muslim Ummah? We can't even open our mouth. I'm not telling fight them. At least open your mouth. Allah says in the Quran in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 108, revile not those, abuse not those who they worship besides Allah, lest in their ignorance they will abuse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot abuse, we cannot criticize, we cannot speak bad about those who they worship, those things they worship besides Allah, lest in their ignorance they will abuse Allah. I'm not abusing their gods. I'm not insulting, I'm asking a simple question. Who is this God? Simple question, and the work is done. I don't have to do PhD in comparative religion. Simple question, who is this God? And the job is done. But we Muslims, we are afraid. You know, if I do dawah with my non-Muslim, I will lose this friendship. We are more interested in keeping friendship with our friend than keeping friendship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's happened to the Muslim Ummah? And believe me, I speak openly, I keep on traveling. Believe me, my Hindu friends respect me. And if I happen to come on the airport, in the customs, that Hindu custom officer tell you, Dr. Zakir Naik, jo kahega, sach kahega, sach ke ilawa kuch nahi kahega. Whatever he will say the truth, but nothing but the truth. This is the oath we take in the, when we go in the court of law. When we want to give a witness in the court of law of India, we say in Hindi, I'm sach kahega, sach ke ilawa kuch. So he's telling on my behalf, that whatever Dr. Zakir Naik will say the truth, nothing but the truth. And they let me pass without checking. Hindu, I'm not doing dawah so that they allow me to go, but they respect me more. When I go to the shopkeeper and they're Dr. Zakir Naik, good discount. They give me free. We Muslims are afraid that if I do dawah, I lose my business. Here, mashallah, I get better discounts. Simple. I'm not doing it for the discount. Please don't get me wrong. I'm doing it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah helps me. And imagine now what you saw in the introduction, the person told me that I'm coming on the channel and mashallah, millions of non-Muslims in India alone. Throughout the world, there are tens of millions watching our channel, non-Muslim, mashallah. The popularity has increased. Imagine, in a voting of non-Muslim, more than 1 billion people in India, more than 1 billion. The non-Muslims included, they voted me. The only religious preacher in the full list of 100 is a Muslim preacher. There is no Hindu preacher. The only religious preacher, there is no Hindu preacher in the full list of 100. There is no Shankaracharya. There is no Christian priest in the full list of 100. The first time any preacher, any religious preacher that came in the top 100 was a Muslim. In a country in which Muslims are in minority, less than 20%. Why? Because of Dawah. We Muslims, we don't guide the non-Muslim, leave us at that. We become party to them. For example, now within a few months, you'll have Christmas coming. Now many of us Muslims, when we meet the Christians, we say, Merry Christmas! Want to increase the friendship. When you are saying Merry Christmas, what are you doing? You are giving Shahada Nauz Billah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has begotten a son on the 25th of December. Leave aside correcting them. When you say Merry Christmas to your Christian friends, you are giving Shahada. You are bearing witness that Nauz Billah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begot a son on the 25th of December. Leave aside correcting them, you are becoming party to them. It is so easy. If it's Christmas time, only thing you have to ask them that why do you celebrate Christmas? So they'll tell you it is the birthday of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Who is this Jesus Christ, peace be upon him? Oh, Jesus Christ is Almighty God. Immediately, your dawah starts. That there is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that he is God or why he says worship me. If any Christian can show me any verse in the Bible, any unequivocal statement, any unambiguous statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says that he is God or worship me, I am ready to accept Christianity. Simple. Make it a merry day for them. Where is the question of you agreeing? Many of the Christians, they love me. Many of the Christians, they revere me, they respect me. Many non-Muslims, they tell me that after watching Peace TV, we have come to know more about religion than what we learned in the past 40, 50 years. They respect me, they love me. Why are you afraid? It is the duty that every Muslim should convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the non-Muslims. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 120, وَلَنْ تَرْضَى عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَنْ نَصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. The Jews and the Christians, they will never be satisfied until you follow their brand of religion. Allah says in the Quran, the Jews and the Christians, they will never be satisfied with the Muslim until you follow their brand of religion, until you become a Jew or a Christian. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse 111. Allah says, وَقَالُوا لَيَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا نَصَارَى. They say, the Jews and Christians, you Muslims, you shall never enter Jannah. With all your piety, with all your tawheed, with all your fasting, with all your salah, with a mark on your forehead, with all the hajj, you shall never enter Jannah unless you become a Jew or a Christian. The Jews and the Christians, they come and tell us, the Muslims, you Muslims, you shall never enter Jannah with all your piety, with all your fasting, with all your hajj, with your salah, with your tawheed, you shall never enter Jannah until you become a Jew or a Christian. Allah says, Tilka amaniyuhum. This is their wishful thinking. Bakwas hai bakwas, vain desires. Kul, tell them, ha tubunanakum, produce your proof in kuntum sadiqeen, but if you're truthful. Tell them to produce the proof if they're truthful. And these Christian missionaries, they have produced the proof. They have produced the Bible in no less than 2,000 different languages. My Bible says this, my Bible says that. My Bible says this, my Bible says that. What do we have to do? Do we have to follow the Bible hook, line, and sinker? Whenever someone shows you his proof, suppose someone shows you his identity card, what do? You verify whether it is correct or not. You don't believe in it unless you verify. So if they have shown their proof, their Bible, what do we have to do? We have to verify it. Have we Muslim verified the proof? When Allah says, Qul hatu burhanakum, produce your proof, what does Allah say? Take the proof and believe in it? In kuntum sadiqeen, but if you're truthful. That means Allah is telling us to verify the proof. These Christian missionaries leave aside verifying their proof. What are they doing? They are using our Burhan, our Quran against us. These Christian missionaries, they are using our Quran against the Muslims. There are hundreds of thousands of Christian missionaries throughout the world, millions of them. They come knocking at the doors of the Muslims and they ask the question, you are a Muslim? I said, yes, we are Muslims. It's mentioned in the Quran that Bible is the word of God. And we say, yes, it's mentioned. Then why don't you follow the Bible? We have no reply. That's the next question. That how many times is the name of your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, mentioned in the Quran? If you know, you'll give the reply that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioned by name in the Quran 5 times. 4 as Muhammad, 1 says Ahmad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the next question. How many times is the name of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, mentioned in the Quran? If you don't know, they will tell you. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, Isa alayhi salam, is mentioned by name in the Quran 25 times. And if you check up, it is correct. That's the next question. Who is greater? A person who mentioned 5 times by name in the Quran is greater, or a person who mentioned 25 times by name in the Quran is greater? Who's greater? 5 or 25? 5 is greater than 25. Who is greater? A person who's mentioned 5 times by name in the Quran is greater, or a person who's mentioned 25 times by name in the Quran is greater? They ask the question, but they don't give you the reply. They let your mind think. They poison your mind. They come knocking at the doors of the Muslims. That's the next question. Your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did he have a mother and father? He said, yes, he had a mother and father. Did Prophet Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, did he have a mother and father? He said, no. He had a mother, but he had no father. That's the next question. Who is greater? A person who's born with a mother and father is greater, or a person who's born without a father is greater? Who's greater? A person who's born with a mother and father is greater, or a person who's born without a father is greater? Who's greater? Who's greater? Person born? Who's greater? They ask the question, but they don't give the reply. They let your mind think. They use as Muslims as a punching bag. They use us like doormats. And believe me, Muslims can't even answer. That's the next question. Your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did he do any miracles? We said, yes, he did many miracles. Did he anytime give life to the dead? And we have to agree that no verse of the Quran, no Sahih Hadith says that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave life to the dead. That's the next question. Did Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, did he give life to the dead? And we have to agree the Quran says, Bi-iznillah, wake up in the name of Allah. Yes, he gave life to the dead. So who's greater? A person who can give life to the dead is greater, or a person who cannot give life to the dead is greater? Who's greater? A person who can give life to the dead is greater, or a person who cannot give life to the dead is greater? They ask the question, but they don't give you the reply. They let your mind think. They poison our minds. They ask the next question. Your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is he physically dead or alive? He said, no, physically he's dead. He's buried in Medina. Is Isa alayhi salam dead or alive? We have to agree that according to the Quran, Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse 158, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised up Isa alayhi salam alive. So who's greater? A prophet who's dead is greater, or a prophet who's alive is greater? Who's greater? A prophet who's dead is greater, or a prophet who's alive is greater? Who's greater? They ask the question, but they don't give you the reply. They let your mind think. They poison your mind. They are using us Muslims like punching bags, like doormats, and we can't even open our mouth. All these replies are given in the Quran. If you read the Quran with understanding, all these replies are there, easy. All the replies are given. You don't have to be a scholar. You have to read the Quran with understanding. All these answers are given. See, doing da'wah is very easy. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64, كل يا أهل الكتاب. Say, O people of the book. تعالوا إلى كلمة سواء بين بينكم. Come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illa Allah. That we worship none but Allah. Wala nushrika bihi shay'an. That we associate to partner with Him. Wala yattakhidha ba'duna ba'dan arbaban min dunillah. That we erect not among ourselves lords and patrons other than Allah. Fain tawallaw. If then they turn back. Faqulu shadu. Say, bear witness. Bi anna muslimun. That we are Muslims bowing our will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تعالوا إلى كلمة سواء بين بينكم. Come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illa Allah. That we worship none but Allah. The most important point while doing da'wah is come to common terms. And in coming to common terms, the most important of this point is Allah na'budu illa Allah. That we worship none but Allah. You may talk anything about Islam. Oh, Islam is very good. It has got so many benefits, so and so things, everything. Good. About science, technology, fine. But if you do not touch Tawheed, all your dawah is useless. If you do not stop the shirk that is there in the lifestyle of the non-Muslim, all your dawah is useless. You can speak about other things than science and technology and Quran and all, fine. To get him to the main point of Tawheed, if you do not touch on Tawheed, Allah na'budu illallah, your dawah is useless. And I've given a talk on concept of God in the major world religions. And if you read the scriptures of the major world religions, all these major world religions, in the scriptures, it is mentioned about one God. It mentions that God is only one. It mentions He is not begotten. It's mentioned that He has got no idols. He alone should be worshipped. Whether it be Hindu scriptures, whether it be Christian scriptures, Jewish scriptures, Parsi scriptures, all these scriptures mention about one God. But we Muslims, we have many excuses for not doing our job. Many Muslims come and tell me, Brother Zakir, our knowledge is very weak. Inshallah, one day when we get enough knowledge, we start doing da'wah. People want to wait till they want to become like Sheikh Ahmad Didad, and then they start doing da'wah. That time will never come. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 4, hadith number 3461, Ballighu anni walau aya. Propagate even if you know one verse about Islam. Even if you know one verse about Islam, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you propagate it. Whatever you know properly, as long as you know it correctly, it's your duty, you have to convey that message to the others. Every Muslim, at least he knows the Shahada. There's no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon the Messenger of Allah. At least go and tell your non-Muslim friends that there is one Allah, there is one God. If he asks you, what is the proof? If you don't know, you come back and do your homework. In this age of science and technology, everything is on your fingertips. You have got internet, you have got DVDs, video cassettes, audio cassettes, books, literature, and I've given a talk on Is the Quran God's Word, where I've proved scientifically the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See that DVD? Memorize it, go and give the answer. Now, you are the master of one answer. That there is one God, and you have proved it scientifically. Go and tell him, why don't you believe in last and final messenger? The non-Muslim will tell you, that why should I believe in him? Don't know the answer, come back. I've given the talk, and there's a book also available, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the world religious scriptures. He's mentioned by name, he's prophesied in the Jewish scriptures, Christian scriptures, Hindu scriptures, Parsi scriptures, Buddhist scriptures. Hear it, memorize it, go and give the answer. Now, you are the master of two answers. Continue. Why don't you offer salah? Why you should offer? Come back and do your homework. I've given the talk on Salah, the programming to righteousness. Slowly, slowly, you keep on gaining knowledge. Don't wait till you become like, say, at least open your mouth. And the moment you open your mouth, Allah helps you. And the best example is a person standing in front of you. If you know my background, I was a stammerer from childhood. If you would have asked me, maybe 20 years back, what is your name? I said, my name is Zakir. That was me. I could have dreamt of becoming the best doctor or surgeon in the world. In your dreams, you can dream of anything. I could have dreamt of becoming the best surgeon in the world, but I could not have dreamt of speaking in front of 25 people. MashaAllah, inspired by Sheikh Ahmed Didar, Balligwani Walawaya, and I started my Balligwani Walawaya. I haven't gone to Darul Uloom. I haven't gone to an Islamic school. Person from medical background started. But I realized when I started speaking to the Christian missionaries, the priests, the fathers, when I had to speak with them, my stammering used to vanish. When I had to speak with the Muslims, again I had to start stammering. And it went on. I came on the stage by default. It was my friend who got cold feet. I was forced to come. It clicked. And now, by Allah's grace, speaking audience of tens of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands. Largest audience is 1 million people live. Just on the saying of Sheikh Ahmed Didar, who repeated the saying of a Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Balligo anya wala ayah. Propagate even if you know one verse. What I heard from Sheikh Didar, one cassette, immediately I started. I didn't wait to see 100 cassettes. Started. And alhamdulillah, the more you repeat, the more Allah gives you. I haven't gone to any Darul Uloom. And imagine now, mashallah, the audiences, live audiences, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. 1 million is the largest audience. On the satellite, 100 million people watching, mashallah. We never did this to get fame. We did it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who, mashallah, opens up the pathway. But we Muslims, we have many excuses. Many Muslims tell me that when we speak to the non-Muslims, they tell us that first go and improve your Muslims. First go and improve your Muslims. See what they're doing. Then come and speak to us. So because the Muslims ourselves are not good, they aren't pious, that's the reason we can't do dawah to the non-Muslims. Today, there are hundreds of thousands of Christian missionaries throughout the world. I ask the question. I ask my Muslim brothers, that do you know these Christian missionaries? You know they have alcohol? Yes, I know. Do you have alcohol? He says, no. Who's better, you or he? I am better. I ask the Muslims, do these Christians, these Christian missionaries, many of them have drugs. Do you have drugs? He said, no. Who's better, he or you? I am better. Now, many of these Christians, they do fornication, they do adultery. Do you do fornication? He said, no. Who's better, him or you? I. With all the defects, these Christian missionaries, with so many defects, yet they're spreading the word of Christianity. Hundreds of them, thousands of them, hundreds and thousands of them. They leave the country and they travel thousands of miles to spread the word of the Bible. Don't give excuse that first go and tell your Muslim brothers. And there are many Muslims who come and tell me, Brother Zakir, first, hum Musalman ko pakka Musalman banayenge, fir hum gair Musalman ko dawa karenge. First, we'll make the Muslims practicing Muslims, and after we make all the Muslims practicing Muslims, then we will go and convey the message to the non-Muslims. I tell them, this time will never come. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he himself could not convince his own relatives. Do you think you're better than the Prophet? Our Prophet, he could not convince his own uncle. Do you think you're better than the Prophet? It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari in the Book of Salah, volume number 1, that the Prophet says that in Medina, there were Muslims who did not come to the mosque for the compulsory Salah. Talking about Jummah Salah. The Prophet says he felt like burning their homes. That means in Medina, there were Muslims who were not good practicing Muslims. Yet the Prophet, he sent messengers, he sent messages to the king of Yemen, to the king of Persia. He sent messages to the king of Byzantine. He did not say, first I'll make all the Muslims 100% practicing Muslims and then I'll convey the message to the non-Muslims. You have to do both simultaneously. When you meet a Muslim, fine, do Islam with him. When you meet a non-Muslim, do Dawah to him. Both are equally important, Dawah and Islam. But if no, which is more important? Which is more important? So I asked him the question. Suppose a patient of heart attack comes to a doctor, stroke. And a patient of common cold comes. And the doctor has limited time. Who should he treat? A person with heart attack or a person with common cold? Who? Heart attack. I'm talking common cold, not swine flu. Huh? Even if swine flu comes, heart attack is more important. Swine flu, it is a media. Media hype. That's another question, we won't deal it now. So the person is a mushrik. He's doing shirk. If you don't convey the message, he will go to hell. The Muslim Islam is important, but more important is dawah. Actually, both are important. If the doctor has time, you should treat both. The person with heart attack also with common cold. So when you meet a Muslim, do Islah. When you meet a non-Muslim, do dawah. Both are equally important. Do both. You can't say, I'll first make all the Muslim pakka Musliman and then do dawah. That time will never come. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the Hajjatul Wida, in the last khutbah he gave, in the last pilgrimage, there were about 110,000 sahabas. He asked them, that did I deliver the message to you? And all of them said, Beshak, they bore witness that yes, you have delivered the message to us. Then the Prophet said, all those who are present here, go and deliver the message to those who are not present here. And do you know, out of this, out of 110,000 sahabas, more than 90,000 sahabas are buried outside Arabia. Doing what? Making Musliman pakka Musliman, making a Muslim more pious Muslim. They were buried outside Arabia doing da'wah to the non-Muslims. More than 80% of the sahabas, they went outside following the commandment of the Prophet, doing da'wah to the non-Muslims. There are many Muslims that have excuses. They say that when we speak to the non-Muslims, they tell me that mind your own business. I tell them, if some non-Muslim tells me that mind your own business, I will tell him, that's what I'm doing. It's my business. It is the business of every Muslim to mind other people's business as far as dawah is concerned. It is the business of every Muslim to mind other person's business as far as removing shirk is concerned. So that's what I'm doing. So when someone says, mind your own business, that's what I'm doing. This is my business. It's the business of every Muslim to be a da'i. At least a part-time da'i, if not a full-time da'i. I'll give you an example. Suppose if you're going on a hill station, along with the family, and you have two kids, a girl and a boy, and your boy, Ahmed, 4 years old, while you're talking to your wife, and your small kid, Ahmed, 4 years old, he slips away from you, and is going towards the edge of the cliff. Now, by the time you realize that he's missing, he's already gone far away. And then you see him that walking close to the edge of the cliff. You want to shout, Ahmed, be careful, you'll fall down. But your voice cannot reach him, far away. There you see an elderly gentleman at the edge of the cliff with his hand folded. He's admiring beauty. You want to shout, Mr. Bhai Saab, save my son, he will die. But your voice cannot reach him. This elderly gentleman, he looks at your son, he smiles at your son, then continues admiring beauty. Your son is coming closer to the edge of the cliff. This man again smiles at him and admires beauty. Next step he takes is over the cliff and he falls and he dies. I'm asking the question. Will you or will you not blame that elderly gentleman for not saving your son? Will you or will you not? Only thing he had to do was stretch his hand. He didn't even have to take a step forward. Only thing he had to do was stretch his hand and your son would have been saved. Will you blame him or not? Yes or no? Yes. But when you tell him, why didn't you save my son? He will say, I was minding my own business. He's right. He didn't push your son, did he? Did he ask your son to jump? No. Why did he be blamed? Did he push him? No. Did he ask him to jump? No. But yet you will say, he at least had wisdom. God gave him wisdom. My son, 4 years old, masoom, innocent. What does he know? Yet you will blame him. Will you or will you not? Of course. Same way, on the day of judgment, these mushriks, these non-Muslims, on the day of judgment, they will blame the Muslims. They will catch your collar. that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Almighty God gave you hidayah, why didn't you tell us? On the day of judgment, these non-Muslims will blame the Muslims and tell that why didn't these Muslims who Allah gave hidayah to, who Allah gave guidance to, why didn't they correct us? It is the duty of every Muslim that he conveys the message of Islam to the non-Muslims. Suppose if you have a neighbor who's a mushrik, and if you have not conveyed the message of Islam to him, and if he dies, Allah will ask him on the day of judgment, why didn't you accept Islam? He will say, Ya Allah, Bari Ta'ala, no one gave me the message. He said, I gave the message directly to you. You did shirk, you'll go to hell. Allah will ask you next, did you convey the message to your neighbor, non-Muslim neighbor? And if you say no, you will follow him. You will follow him. It's the duty of every Muslim that he should convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to those who are not aware of it. But we Muslims, we have many excuses. We have many excuses for not doing the job. Many of the Muslims tell me, you know, but Allah says in the Quran, lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. The Quran says, lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. No, to you is your way, to me is mine. So why should we do dawah? What they're quoting is a verse of the Quran from Surah Kafirun, chapter 109, verse number 6. What they're quoting is the last verse of Surah Kafirun. It is out of context. If you really want to quote Surah Kafirun, quote in context from verse number 1. Surah Kafirun, chapter 109, verse number 1 to 6. Kul ya ayyuhal kafirun, la abdu ma ta'budun, wala antum abduna ma'bud, wala ana abdun ma'budtum, wala antum abduna ma'bud, lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. Say to those who reject faith, I will not worship that which you worship, nor will you worship what I worship. I will not worship what you want me to worship, nor will you worship what I worship. To use your way, to me is mine. After you have delivered the message of Islam, and then if he does not accept it, then you can say that I will not worship what you worship, you will not worship what I worship. To use your way, to me is mine. Unless you have not delivered the message of Islam to the non-Muslim, you cannot say lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. Muslims tell me, but doesn't Allah say la ikraha fiddeen, there's no compulsion in religion? Again, out of context. What the quote thing is the words of Quran from Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 256. It does say la ikraha fiddeen, there's no compulsion in religion, but it continues. But truth stands out clear from error. And if you reject the evil one and believe in Allah, you have grasped the most strongest handhold, which will never break. When you say la ikraha fiddeen, there's no compulsion in religion, you also have to say truth stands out clear from error. You convey the truth to them. You can't force anyone to accept Islam. You can't force anyone to accept the Quran or accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't put a gun on his forehead. You can't take a sword. It's not allowed. But at least you convey the message. You can't force, I agree, but at least convey. Tell them truth stands out clear from error. So unless you have not conveyed the message, you cannot say lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. After conveying the message, you can say la ikraha fiddeen, there is no compulsion in religion. You can't force anyone, but at least convey the message. It's the duty of every Muslim to at least be a part-time dai. It's a fard. It's the duty of every Muslim to at least be a part-time dai. Dawah is a fard for every Muslim. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1 to 3, Wal Asr, innal insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bis sabr. That by the token of time, Allah is taking the promise that human beings are in khasara, they are in loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deeds, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. For any human being to go to Jannah, minimum 4 criteria are required: iman, righteous deeds, exhorting people to truth, that is doing dawah, and exhorting people to patience and perseverance. If any one of these 4 criteria is missing, you shall not enter Jannah. You may be a very good Muslim, you may be offering 5 times salah, you may be fasting in the month of Ramadan, you may perform Hajj, but if you don't do dawah, you shall not enter Jannah according to Surah Al-Asr. If Allah wants to forgive you, and put you in Jannah, it is Allah's prerogative. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 48 and Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 116 that if Allah pleases, He may forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk He'll not forgive. Because a person who commits shirk has strayed away far. So if Allah wants to forgive you and put you in Jannah, it is Allah's prerogative. But under normal circumstances, according to Surah Al-Asr, if you don't do dawah, you shall not enter Jannah. Only dawah is also not sufficient. All four are equally important. Iman, righteous deed, watawasaw bil haq, that is dawah and islah, watawasaw bil sabr, inviting people to patience and perseverance. So it's compulsory that every Muslim should at least be a part-time dai. You don't have to be a full-time dai like Shaykh Didar, or a full-time dai like me. At least be a part-time dai, it's a fard. Allah also says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 104, one of the verses which the Qari, Farik, he recited, which says, Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 104, that let there arise out of you a band of people who are inviting towards good, enjoining what is right, and forbidding what is wrong. Allah is talking about full-time dais. How you have full-time doctors, full-time engineers, full-time lawyers, full-time businessmen. How many full-time dais do you have? How many dais do you have which travel to different parts of the world and convey the message? You can count them on your fingertips. Allah says in the Quran that let there arise out of you a band of people, dais, who are inviting people to the good, enjoining what is right and forbidding what is wrong. These are the ones that shall attain felicity. I mean, these are the ones that will attain a higher grade in Jannah, Allah says. Here Allah is talking full-time dais. There is no better profession than a profession of a dai. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 125, Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal mu'azid al hasna wajadun billati hasan, that invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. I would like to end this talk by giving the message which is repeated in the Quran in no less than 3 different places. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 33, in Surah Saf, chapter number 61, verse number 9, and Surah Fatah, chapter 48, verse number 28, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَالدِّينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ وَلَوْ قَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ, that Allah has sent His messenger with guidance and the religion of truth so that it will prevail over all the other religions, all the other isms, whether it be Christianism, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Atheism, Secularism, Modernism. Islam is destined to supersede all, كُلِّهِ, master them all. وَلَوْ قَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ, how much the mushrik don't like it, how much the idol worshippers don't like it. Allah mentioned this twice in Surah Tawbah chapter 9 verse 33 and Surah Saf chapter 16 verse number 9, and the third time in Surah Fatah chapter 48 verse number 28, Allah repeats the message, a different ending. Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَالدِّينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ وَقَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا, that Allah sent His messenger with guidance. He has sent the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, with guidance and the religion of truth, so that it will prevail over all the other religions, over all the other isms, whether it be Christianism, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Parsiism, Sikhism, Atheism, Modernism, Secularism. Islam is destined to supersede all, kulli, master them all. وَقَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا, and enough is Allah as a witness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not require you and me the rubbish that we are. Allah does not require you and me to make His deen prevail. If we think that if we don't do dawah, Islam would not spread. If I start thinking that if I don't do dawah, Islam would not spread, I'm the biggest fool in the world. Allah does not require you and me to make His deen prevail, the rubbish that we are. Allah doesn't require you and me. Allah is sufficient to make His deen prevail. Allah is giving us an opportunity to make hay while the sun is shining. Allah has promised His deen will prevail. whether you and I do da'wah or not, Islam is bound to prevail. Allah is giving you an opportunity to do a prophet's job and to earn a prophet's reward. I'd like to end the talk with the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 33, which changed me from a doctor of a body to a doctor of soul. When I became a medical doctor because I thought it was the best profession in the world. It is a good profession. But when I found a better profession, the profession of a dai, I changed my profession from a doctor of a body to a doctor of soul. I will end the talk with the verse of the Quran of Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 33, where Allah says that وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَالَ مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا قَالَ إِنِّي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. That who is better in speech than one who invites people to the way of their Lord, works righteousness and says that I am a Muslim. وآخر دعوان الحمد لله رب العالمين.
JazakAllah khairan, Dr. Zakir Naik, for this. Surely, if it wasn't for da'wah, people like me wouldn't stand here tonight. It's very eye-opening, Dr. Zakir Naik. And enlightening talk on da'wah or destruction. Thank you very much. Now we move on a very interesting part of this program, the open question and answer session. To analyze the topic da'wah or destruction adequately, for all our present here today, in the limited time available, we would like the following guidelines to be followed during the question and answer session. First, questions asked should be on the topic. Second, questions not relevant to the topic, including any general question on religion, will not be allowed. Third, kindly state your question briefly and to the point. Fourth, only one question at a time may be asked. For your second question, you will have to get at the back of the row again and await your second chance to ask a question. Fifth, non-Muslim brothers and sisters will be given first preference to ask the questions. Sixth, three mics have been provided for the audience in the auditorium. The first mic in the front next to the stage on my left side, and the second in the middle aisle over there for the gents, and the third mic in the ladies section. Please stand in a queue at one of the mics if you wish to put a question to the speaker, and speak into the mic only when the mic handling assistants hand over the mic to you. We will allow one question at each of the mics in clockwise rotation. Kindly state your name and profession before putting forth your question. May we have the first question, please?
As was mentioned by the coordinator, we'd request that if in the audience we have any non-Muslim brothers and sisters, we would give them the first opportunity. They are our guests today. And we'd request that in the audience, if there are any non-Muslim brothers and sisters, please come up on the microphone. You can jump the queue. And I request the volunteers that to give first chance to the non-Muslims. And non-Muslims can ask any questions on Islam and comparative religion. Even if they want to attack Islam, no problem. They want to attack the Quran, no problem. I'm young, I can take it. Any question? Any question, any clarification, any misunderstanding? This is your opportunity. You can ask any question on Islam and comparative religion. This is the opportunity. You can ask questions on Islam, on Christianity, on Hinduism. Please feel free. Even if it's a criticism, I can take it. Believe me, it's my profession. So I'd request the volunteers that if they're non-Muslims, they should be given the first chance. If there are any non-Muslims standing in the queue, bring them in the front of the queue. All the non-Muslims, you can be rest assured that you're in safe hands. Don't worry, even if it's a criticism, I can take it. You're most welcome. We have a microphone for the gents on my right, one microphone for the gents on my left, and for ladies behind. First, we'll give the opportunity to ladies. If there are any non-Muslim amongst the ladies, we first start with the ladies and then come on the gents. If there are any non-Muslim sisters who have any questions, please come up on the microphone for the ladies that's behind in the ladies section. Any sister, any non-Muslim sister would like to ask a question? Any non-Muslim sister? Okay, by the time they're coming, we'll entertain our non-Muslim brother here. Please mention your name and profession so that I'll be in a better position to reply. Please keep your questions brief. It should be in 3 or 4 sentences. If it's more than 3 or 4 sentences, it's a speech. Now the speech is over. So ask the question in 2 or 3 sentences. Please mention your name and profession and ask a question. Yes, brother.
My name is Gagan Sethi. I'm a job seeker. In my religion, as you know, that Guru Nanak is the founder of our religion. Is he a Muslim? That's my question.
Brother asked the question. Our young brother who's a Sikh, comes from India, he says that he's a Sikh and the founder of his religion is Guru Nanak. He asked me the question, was Guru Nanak Muslim or not? Brother, Muslim is an Arabic word which means a person who submits his will to Almighty God. Anyone who submits his will to Almighty God, he's a Muslim. Now, since I did not meet Guru Nanak personally, I cannot say definitely whether he's a Muslim or not, but I have read the Guru Granth Sahib, that is the sacred scripture of the Sikh, and Sikhism is a religion which believes in 10 gurus. The first who's the founder is Guru Nanak Sahib, and the last is Guru Gobind Sahib. Brother asked me the question, do I consider Guru Nanak to be a Muslim? If I read the Guru Granth Sahib, if I read the first verse, first volume, first verse is known as Japuji of Guru Granth Sahib, known as Adi Granth. The first volume, first verse is called as Japuji. It says that Almighty God is true. He is the creator. He is free from fear and want. He is self-existing. He is eternal. He's great and he's compassionate. Now, based on this, it is somewhat similar to the verse of the Quran of Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1-4, which says, Qul huwa Allahu ahad, says Allah one only. Japuji also says that he's not begotten. Says Allah one only. Allahu samad, Allah, the absolute and eternal. Lam lid wa lam yulad, he begets not nor is begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad, there's nothing like him. Again, if you read in Sikhism, Sikhism is a religion which is a monotheistic religion. And it calls Almighty God as Ek Omkara in the unmanifest form. And manifest form is called as Omkara. And there are various attributes given to Almighty God in the Guru Granth Sahib. In Sikhism, Almighty God is also called as Akal, eternal. He's called as Kartar, the creator. He's called as Sahib, Lord. He's called as Parvardigar, the Cherisher. He's called as Rahim, the Beneficent. He's called as Kareem, the Benevolent. He's called as Wahe Guru, the One True God. Now, based on these readings of Guru Granth Sahib, based on these, I think that Guru Nanak was a Muslim. Muslim means a person who submits his will to Almighty God. But what the scholars say, that this Sikhism is a religion that emerged in the latter part of the 15th century in the land of Punjab, in the land of the Five Rivers. And the scholars say it's an amalgamation of Islam and Hinduism. That's what scholars say. That based on these verses, Guru Nanak believed in one God. He believed that God was begotten. He had no images. He was all powerful. I personally have not read about Guru Nanak, whether he believed in Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him or not. I don't know personally. Personally, I haven't met him. But based on these teachings, it seems to be that he is a Muslim. Seems to be. Whether he was or not, I don't know. But unfortunately, as time passes, there is corruption in it. Like if you ask me, was Jesus Christ a Muslim? Undoubtedly. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was a Muslim. Why? Quran says that. Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 52, that Isa alayhi salam was a Muslim. But there's no verse in the Quran saying Guru Nanak will be a Muslim. So based on the verse, but if I read the Bible, if I read verses of the Bible, what Jesus Christ says, it proves that he's a Muslim. But there are other interpolation in the Bible. There are concoction in the Bible, which undoubtedly cannot be the word of God. So I cannot attribute this to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. But if I check what is right, whether what the Bible says, because Quran says I believe, Isa alayhi salam was a Muslim. Abraham alayhi salam was a Muslim. Surah Imran chapter 3 verse 67. He was not a Jew or a Christian, he was a Muslim. So because the Quran clarifies, I've got no doubt. As far as Guru Nanak is concerned, because Quran does not clarify, but seeing the verses, I consider you may be he was a Muslim. But what you have to realize later on, as I said, there was corruption in the Bible. Even here what we find, that people have started worshipping the Guru Granth Sahib. Guru Nanak didn't say you have to worship the Guru Granth Sahib. They even have, if you go to the Sikh temple, other things, which are deviations. So based on these deviations, I cannot say that they're Muslims. But go back to your scripture. If you go back to your scripture and believe in Almighty God, who's not begotten, who's one, who has got no images, and worship Him alone, then you will go back to the original faith, that is Islam. Hope that answers the question.
May we have a question from the middle aisle?
My name is Badi Panilag. I'm a Filipino and a Christian. I just want to ask doctor regarding this Mariam. Mariam gave birth to Jesus, right? I just want to know if it is mentioned in Quran, how was Jesus given to Mariam? Is it mentioned in Quran? That's all, doctor.
Our Christian Filipino brother has asked a very good question. He wants to know about Mariam alayhi salam. How did she give birth to Isa alayhi salam? And what does the Quran speak about that?
Yeah.
Brother, if you read the Quran, there is a full chapter called as Surah Maryam. Chapter by the name of Mary.
Mary,
who was the mother of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. If you read the Bible, out of the 73 books of the Bible, out of all the 66 books of the Bible, there is no book by the name of Mary or Maryam.
Yes.
There is no. But if you read the Quran, there is a chapter by the name of Maryam, that is Mary, the mother of Isa alayhi salam. And the Quran says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 42, it says, وَإِسْقَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ Behold the angel said of Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَطَهَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكِ لِصَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ That we have chosen thee and purified thee and chosen thee above the women of all nations. Imagine, this verse of the Quran was revealed to an Arab, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen a Jewish woman, a woman above all the other women, and purified her. You know, actually, it is bad marketing. The Jews were against the Arabs. And the audience of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were Arabs. Now, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that Almighty God has chosen a Jewish woman, Maryam alayhi salam, Mother Mary, as a woman above all the other women. This is what the Quran says. Women above the all nations. But this is a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has no option. It is not his words. It is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That whatever is revealed to him, he has to believe. Furthermore, if you read in Surah Imran chapter 3, verse number 43, 44, 45, you come to verse number 47. It says, the main question that you ask, what does it speak about the birth of Isa alayhi salam? It says that when Archangel Gabriel, in Surah Imran chapter 3, verse 47, comes to Maryam and says that you shall give birth to a son. So she says that how shall I have a son when no man has touched me? Similarly, if you read in the Bible, a similar incident says that how shall I have a son when I knoweth no man? Knoweth no man means she does not know any man. Knoweth no man here means not knowing, it means knowing sexually. We understand the language of the Bible. When Maryam alayhi salam says in the Bible, I knoweth no man means does not know any man sexually. When the Quran says when no man has touched me, it doesn't mean physical touch, it means sexual touch. That no man has touched me. But then the Quran continues. Iza qida amran, that when Allah decrees a matter, فَإِنَّمَا يَلْقُلُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ Allah says be and it is. When Allah decrees a matter, He says be and it is. So Allah says, when Almighty God willed that she should give birth to a son, it takes place. Kun fayakun, be and it is. So the birth of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was a miraculous birth. It was a miraculous birth. There was no male intervention. That's why we believe that Isa alayhi salam was born miraculously without any male intervention. Further, when you go in Surah Maryam, chapter number 19, verse number 28 to 32 onwards, when Maryam alayhi salam, when she has the child, the newborn, Isa alayhi salam in the hand, people start alleging. They start insinuating her. And they tell her that, how come you have the son? You come from the family of Harun alayhi salam, from Aaron. How can you do such a low thing, trying to insinuate her that she did adultery? The people started insinuating her that this woman, without marriage, she had a child, insinuating that she did adultery. She was speechless. She could not reply. Immediately, Isa alayhi salam, from the arms of his mother, he replies and says that I am a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He protects his mother and he replies, I've been sent as a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give glad tidings on you. Now the first miracle done by Isa alayhi salam in the Quran is he speaks when he was an infant. Few days old, he speaks from the mother's arm. The first miracle done in the Bible is, if you read your Bible, that when there was a party and all the wine gets over, so the host is worried, there's no wine for the people. So Isa alayhi salam says, get water. And he converts water into wine. That was the first miracle. In the Quran, first miracle was, he protects his mother. And he supports his mother and speaks on behalf of the mother when he was in the arm of his mother, just when he was born. So this is how the Quran respects Maryam alayhi salam and uplifts her and calls her as the best woman amongst all the nations. No such title is given in the Bible. That's the reason I say we respect and love Maryam alayhi salam more than the Christians. We love and respect Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, more than the Christians. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you, Doctor.
May we have a question from the ladies section, please?
Hello. Yes, that's right. Hi, my name is Anna. I want to ask, what happens to non-Muslims who have never been exposed to Islam? And what if a non-Muslim says that the miracles of Jesus are bigger than the ones that Muhammad performed?
Sisters asked two questions basically. What a non-Muslim who says, who has never been exposed to Islam, what happens to them? And secondly, if a non-Muslim comes and says that the miracles of Isa alayhi salam are greater, what happens to them? Point number one, if a non-Muslim comes and tells me that they have not been exposed to Islam, today, in this world of science and technology, it's difficult. Maybe if you ask this question 50 years back, it was possible. Today, in this age of science and technology, especially the media bombarding misconception about Islam, you're exposed to Islam, maybe the wrong Islam, maybe pseudo-Islam, that Muslims are terrorists, Muslims are fundamentalists, Islam is a religion of killing, it degrades the woman, it subjugates the woman. They may be exposed to Islam, but wrong Islam. Now, what happens to a non-Muslim who's not exposed to the right teachings of Islam? I feel if a non-Muslim hears something in the media, or any human being hears something in the media, he should not take it for granted. The Quran says in Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse number 6, whenever you get information, check it up before you pass it on to the third person. Whenever you get information, it is important that the person checks up whether the information is right or wrong. As far as the message of Islam is concerned, what if a non-Muslim may be living in an island, maybe living in Timbuktu, or living somewhere where he doesn't have any knowledge of Islam? First, it's the duty of every Muslim to convey the message to non-Muslim, irrespective whether we convey or not. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 53, Allah says, سَنُورِهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ. That soon we shall show them our signs in the furthest regions of the horizons until it is clear to them that this is the truth. Allah says that He will show the signs to every human being before the human being dies. He will show His signs in the furthest regions of the horizons until it is clear to them that this is the truth. So Allah takes it up upon Himself that He will convey this message to each and every human being, whether he's born in a Muslim family or non-Muslim family, whether he's born in a Muslim land or non-Muslim land. Allah will give this message to every human being. That's the reason there were some surveys done in 1950 in two tribes. Now these two tribes, the Kapauku tribe and the Australian Aborigines, these two tribes did not come in contact with modern civilization till as late as 1950. When the researchers went and tried to find out what was their way of life, these people, they believed that God was one. They believed he alone should be worshipped. They believed he did not beget anyone. They did the sajda, they did prostration for worshipping that God. It was everything of Islam but in name. So when no external influence comes on a human being, that person submits his will to God. That is the reason our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, every child is born in Deen al-Fitr. Every child is born in the innate religion. He is born as a Muslim. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, every child is born as a Muslim. Muslim means a person who submits his will to God. Later on, that person may be influenced by his parents, by his teachers, by his elders. He may start doing fire worship. He may start doing idol worship. And then may deviate on the wrong track. That's the reason when a non-Muslim accepts Islam, the more appropriate word is revert. He was a Muslim, born as a Muslim. He gets converted to a wrong religion, comes back to the original faith, that is Islam. So the right word is revert. So coming to your question, every child, if any child, if you take three children, one born to a Christian, one born to a Jew, one born to a Hindu, isolate these three children completely from any external influence. And when they grow up and you try and find out what is their way of life, it will be nothing but Islam. Only after external influence, they start deviating and worshipping wrong things and having wrong ideas. This is scientifically proven. Furthermore, sister, where your second question is concerned, that what if someone doesn't know Islam and thinks that Jesus Christ did miracles? I do agree Jesus Christ did miracles. But sister, miracle is not the test. If you believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, if you read in the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 24, verse number 24, says that for there shall arise many false Christ and false prophets and will do wonders and miracles, and if it were possible, shall deceive the very elect. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says miracle is not the test. There shall arise many false Christ and false prophets and shall do wonders and miracles, and if it were possible, shall deceive the elect. That means Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says miracle is not the test. Miracle does not make a person a god. Miracle does not make a person superior, because all the miracles that were done by all the prophets were done by Almighty God himself. All the miracles done by Moses, the parting of the sea, when he threw the stick, it became into a snake. It was done by Almighty God. All the miracles that Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did were done by Almighty God. Same with Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, splitting of the moon were done by Almighty God. I would like to tell you that Islam is the only non-Christian faith which makes an article of faith to believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We believe that he was one of the mightiest messengers of Almighty God. We believe that he was the Messiah, translated Christ. We believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention, which many modern day Christians today do not believe. We believe that he gave life to the dead with God's permission. We believe that he healed those born blind and lepers with God's permission. The Christians and the Muslims, we are going together. But one may ask, then where is the parting of ways? The parting of ways is that most of the Christians, they believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was Almighty God. They believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, claimed divinity. In fact, if you read the Bible, there is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, always is worship me. If, sister, you can point out any unequivocal statement, any unambiguous statement from any version of the Bible in which Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, always says worship me, I am ready to accept Christianity today. In fact, if you read the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 28, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29. My Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28. I cast out devil with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20. I with the finger of God cast out devil. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 30. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. For I seek not my will, but the will of Almighty God. Anyone who says, I seek not my will, but the will of Almighty God, he's a Muslim. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is a Muslim. He never claimed divinity. He never said that he was Almighty God. He clearly mentioned, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 24. He said that the words that you hear are not mine, but my Father's who has sent me. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 17, verse number 3. This is life eternal, so that you may know there is one God and Jesus Christ who thou hast sent. It clearly mentioned that Jesus Christ was a messenger. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 19, verse number 16 to 18, that a person approaches Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and asks him, that good master, what good things should I do so that I shall enter eternal life? So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, why thou callest me good? Leave aside God, G-O-D. Why thou callest me good, G-O-D? For there is only one good, and that is the Father in heaven. And if thou want to enter eternal life, you keep the commandments. Jesus Christ didn't say that if you want to enter eternal life, if you want to go to paradise, believe I'm God. He didn't say that you believe that I died on the cross for your sins. What he said, if you want to enter eternal life, if you want to enter paradise, you keep the commandments. And it's clearly mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22, that ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles which God did by him, and you are witness to it. What does it say? Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. Regarding a question of miracles, what does the Bible say? Book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. A man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you witnessed it. So all the credit goes to Almighty God. And Jesus Christ was a man. All the miracles were done through Almighty God. So all the miracles, all the messengers did were done by Almighty God. They came to testify there was one God. But Jesus Christ also said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, that I have many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that hear shall he speak. He shall glorify me. Now this prophecy is prophesied no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So if you're a true Christian, and if you believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I have many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that hear shall he speak. He shall glorify me. This prophecy is prophesizing no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So if you're a true Christian, you should believe in the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Hope that answers the question, sister.
May we move now to the first row.
My name is Vinod. I'm a sales engineer. This is my cousin. As per Quran, the mankind has came to earth through Adam and Eva. How they developed the mankind through their own children and how it is spread through all over the world. How can we agree?
Well, that was the question that according to the Quran, the humankind came from Adam and Eve, peace be upon them. How come all the human beings were born? What he's saying is right, as the Quran says in Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse number 13. Ya ayyuha an-nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa unsa wa jalnakum shu'uban wa qabaila litarafu inna akramakum min Allah yatqakum inna Allah alimun khabir, which means, O humankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female, and I've divided you into nations and tribes so that you may recognize each other, not that you may despise each other. And the most honored in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the person who has taqwa. This verse of the Quran says that we humankind have been created from a single pair of male and female, Adam and Eve. Your basic question is, how did the human beings then evolve? What are you trying to tell me? That how were the children born? Adam and Eve, through them we had many children. Cain, Abel, Habel, Kabil, mentioned in the Quran. Fine, that's easy to understand. But how did they procreate? Indirectly asking that, what about incest? That means, can a brother and sister marry or not? The laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the basic law is the same. There's one God, etc. Salah and everything. But the minute things keep on changing depending upon time. Today, according to all the scriptures, whether it be Quran, whether it be Bible, incest is haram. That means marrying or having sex with the blood brother sister is prohibited. But at the time of Adam alayhi salam, this was not the law. The law was that whenever the children were born, the brothers and sisters born in the same delivery, they were prohibited from marrying each other. But brothers and sisters from different delivery, it's possible. So that was the law that time, because humanity had to expand. Later on, the law came that blood brothers and sisters, irrespective of the same delivery or other delivery, they should not marry. So this is the law today. Because Quran says in Surah Maidah chapter 5 verse number 3, on this day have I completed your religion for you and have chosen for you Islam and complete the favor on you. After this, 1400 years back, when the Quran was revealed, Surah Maidah chapter 5 verse number 3, after this, nothing new can be added, nothing can be subtracted from the Quran. We have to follow it. But previously, the minor laws were different. At the time of Adam alayhi salam, brothers and sisters from the same delivery were prohibited to marry. Other deliveries they could. That's how the humanity expanded and how now we have more than 6 billion people. Hope that answers the question.
May we move now back to the middle row?
Good evening, doctor. Sales manager from shipping company. Is the hell and paradise are there? How as a common person I believe? I don't believe in any religion.
Well, that's the question that how do I know there's hell and heaven? How will a common man believe? I don't believe in a religion. Brother, what is the definition of religion? Religion is a way of life. How you lead your life. Many people say that, I don't mind, I'm just a human being, I'm born, I will do test and error, and I will know how to lead a life. For example, you go to a forest. You are going to a forest the first time. You don't know whether the fruits are poisonous or not. If you start eating any fruit, you may end up eating a fruit which is poisonous and you may die. What do? You ask an expert. Right or wrong? When you get sick, who do you go to, brother? When you are sick, who do you go to? Why? The doctor is an expert in treating sickness, correct? You can't say, I am a human being, I will treat myself. No. That's what the Quran says in Surah Nahl. The Quran says in Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse 43, and Surah Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 7, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهَلِ الزِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. If you don't know, ask the person who is expert. Similarly, to lead a life, we have to ask the expert. Now, who is the expert? Who is the expert? The person who created us. Who created us? It's Almighty God. So, we have to follow the commandment of Almighty God. If you do not believe in Almighty God, you should listen to my video cassette, Is the Quran God's Word? Where I've proved logically and scientifically the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're an atheist, are you an atheist, brother? Are you an atheist?
Pardon me?
Are you an atheist?
No, no.
Not an atheist. So what do you? Do you believe in God?
Actually, I believe in the power. But...
Fine. That means you believe in God. You want to call it power, you want to call it supernatural, you believe in God.
It's like, I believe something.
Something. You don't know the name. That name is God. You may call it power, you may call it anything. If you don't believe in God, then you listen to my video cassette, Is the Quran God's Word. If you don't know who that power is, yet you listen to my cassette, Is the Quran God's Word, where I've proven scientifically, undoubtedly, existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Quran is the word of Almighty God. Now coming to your question, if you say about power, that means you believe in a religion. Because religion by definition, according to Oxford Dictionary, religion means a belief in a supernatural controlling power. Power word is there. That means you believe in a religion. Religion, according to Oxford Dictionary, means a belief in a supernatural controlling power, a personal god or gods that deserve obedience and worship. That means you believe in religion, you don't know the definition of religion. So don't say, I don't believe in religion. Religion is an English word, brother. Religion is an English word. If you open the Oxford Dictionary, it says, religion means a belief in a superhuman controlling power, and you believe in a power. Or a personal god, or god that is a worship or obedience. To know more about that power, you see my video, because that is the Quran God's word. Now coming to your question, basic question, how will I prove that there is hell and heaven? Now, if you hear my video cassette, I've proved many scientific aspects in the Quran. If you use science to the Quran, what we come to know that whatever the Quran has said today, 80% can be proved to be 100% correct scientifically. Quran speaks about various scientific facts, which we came to know recently. It speaks about astronomy, it speaks about the spherical nature of the earth, it speaks about the Big Bang, it speaks about the light of the moon, it's not its own light, reflected light, it speaks about the water cycle, it speaks about biology, it speaks about botany, it speaks about zoology, it speaks about embryology, all these things. Now, today is the age of science and technology. If we put this test of science to the Quran, what we come to know, 80% whatever the Quran has said is 100% perfectly correct. The balance 20% is ambiguous, neither right, neither wrong. Out of the 20%, not even 0.01% has been proved to be wrong by scientific fact. It is ambiguous. So what my logic says, when 80% is 100% correct, and not even 0.01% of the 20% is proved wrong, so my logic says that inshallah, even that 20% will be correct. It's a logical belief. I, being a medical doctor, Quran speaks about astronomy, embryology, genetics, everything perfect. Then you ask me, brother, you being a doctor, you believe in hell? You believe in heaven? You believe in jinn? You believe in life after death? So my logic says, inshallah, even the other 20% in the Quran, which science hasn't reached up to that level. Science cannot prove it. Maybe science will prove 50 years later or 10 years later. But today science hasn't reached that level. So in this way, I believe whatever 20% which science hasn't proved to be right or wrong, inshallah, even that will be right. This is one way to prove about hell and heaven. There's another way, simple way, without reading Quran. Brother, I am asking a simple question. Is robbing good or bad? Robbing is good or bad?
Robbing is bad.
Bad.
Yeah.
Raping a girl is good or bad?
No, bad.
Bad. Okay, now I'm asking you a question. Logically, I suppose happen to be the biggest mafia. Hypothetically, I am a big robber. You prove to me logically and scientifically. I am a very logical person. I am a scientific person. I am a logical person and scientific person. You prove to me why robbing is bad for me, and I will stop robbing. Only one reason you give me, one good reason why robbing is bad for me, and I will stop robbing.
It hurts others. It hurts people.
It hurts others. What difference does it make to me? If it hurts, if I rob 1,000 riyal, it is benefiting me. I can see movie. I can go to a 5-star hotel. What difference does it make whether it hurts others? Does it hurt me? I told you, prove to me why it is bad for me, not for others. I am least bothered about the others. Why is it bad for me? When I'm robbing 1,000, if it hurts him, no problem. What difference does it make to me? If it hurts somebody else, does it make a difference to me? I can enjoy, I can see movie. I can eat chicken biryani. I asked you, give me one logical reason why it is bad for me, not why it is bad for others. I'm a big mafia. I'm powerful. I'm a scientific person, logical person. Prove to me one good reason, logical, why robbing is bad. I will stop robbing. Come on. Another try, brother. Another try. One more try. Why it is bad? No answer. No answer. Try. There are 20, 30 reasons, 100 reasons you can give.
You know, actually, as you said, the religion means the way of life.
Not religion. Why robbing is bad? Tell me. Don't go to religion.
No. I'm coming to the point.
No, not point. First, tell me why robbing is bad. We'll come back to your point afterwards. I'll come to your point afterwards.
When that is the way of life.
Not way of life. Tell me why robbing is bad according to you. Why it is bad for me, I will stop robbing.
Up to me, you know, it hurts others. So.
But
you know,
what difference does it make to me when it hurts others? Does it hurt me?
Of course, you know.
Why it is bad for me, not why it is bad for others.
Once we come to the society, you know, we have to face them.
Okay, once we come to society, you have to face them. I'm facing them. What's wrong? Why it is bad for me?
The society won't respect us.
What difference does it make whether respect or not? I can eat chicken biryani. I can go and see a movie. I can go to a 5-star hotel. What difference does it make to me if society respects or not? Imagine someone respects society. The poor person doesn't have food to eat. He'll be happy?
No.
You require food to eat or not? You require food to survive? Only society respecting the person is starving to death. You know, in India, Thousands of people are starving to death. What difference does it make? I must give me one good reason why robbing is bad, I stop robbing. Why it is bad for me? Can anyone else help him out? Why robbing is bad? Why robbing is bad? There are various answers, I'll help you out. You may say, police will catch you. Good logical reason. Police will come and catch you, correct, right or wrong?
Correct.
But you didn't give the, I'm helping you out. But brother, I told you I'm a powerful mafia. The police is in my pocket. Ministers are in my pocket. Big mafia. See, all the top mafia, the police is in the pocket, they're on my payroll. The police is on my payroll, what will they catch me? Small robber like you should not rob. You'll get arrested. I'm a top mafia. The police is on my payroll, even the ministers are on my payroll, they're in my pocket. So small robber like you should not rob, big mafia like me can rob. Another reason, I'll help you out. Maybe somebody will come and rob you. Yes. No one can rob me because I got 100 bodyguards. All of them hiding behind the stage. Bodyguards. Small robber robs, somebody will rob him. No one can rob me because I got bodyguards. Hundreds of bodyguards with AK-47. So logically, you cannot prove at all why robbing is bad. With all your science and technology, you cannot prove robbing is bad.
So shall I take it in that way? You know, it is to make people fear that, you know, if you do wrong things, then when you die.
What wrong thing? Where is robbing wrong? First to prove it is wrong, na? Where is robbing wrong? You haven't proved to me robbing is wrong. When you prove robbing is wrong, then you can say don't do wrong things, na? Therefore, what is good, what is right, you require a creator to tell you. You require a doctor to tell you what food is good, what food is bad. This fruit is poisonous, this is healthy for you. Apple is healthy for you, wild berries are poisonous for you. A doctor tells you. There's no better doctor than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Logically speaking, brother, that mafia has got bodyguards. No one can harm him. And believe me, there are many examples. He dies a very comfortable death. But I am asking a simple question now, brother. Don't you think that there should be justice? Brother?
Yes.
Justice. Someone should punish him or not?
Law is there.
But the law cannot punish every human being here. Why? There are many mafias in Italy. There are many underworld people in India. And the law can't do anything to them. The law is in their pocket. But yet, you as a common man, don't you think you should be punished? Raping is good or bad? There are many people who rape. They rape the girls. No, nothing. The law cannot catch them. So don't you think he should be punished? Yes or no?
Yes.
But there are many people you see in this world who are big mafias. They die comfortable. They are rich. They are millionaires. There should be some justice. The reply is given by Creator. Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 185. Allah says, "Kullu nafsin zaiqatul maut." Every soul shall have a taste of death. But the final recompense will be on the day of judgment. This life is just mere chattels of deception. If there is no life after death, this life is of injustice. What we say that the total justice would be on the day of judgment. Our Creator Almighty God will give justice. I tell the person, fine, you may be a big robber. For example, you are that mafia now, I am a Muslim. No one can harm you, police is in your pocket. Then I ask you, justice is required, yes. If someone robs you, no one can rob you, agree. But don't you feel there should be justice? There are many robbers, there are many evils, there are many criminals who go scot-free. Unless there is life after death, you cannot prove robbing is bad. You cannot prove raping is bad. Unless there's life after death, no humanity, no book on humanity. No Mother Teresa, no Mahatma Gandhi can prove robbing is bad without the concept of life after death. Because I'm asking you a question. Hitler, history tells us Hitler incinerated 6 million Jews. How many Jews?
6 million.
6 million. Suppose the law catches Hitler. What punishment can you give Hitler so that you can compensate for? He has burnt 6 million Jews alive. Can you give him any punishment? Brother?
We have to put him in jail till his life death.
Okay, will it be equivalent to burning 6 million Jews? Is burning better or putting in jail better?
it's burning is, of course.
So maximum you can do is burn him alive. But that will be equal to 1 out of 6 million. What about the remaining 5,999,999 people? What about that? What justice is your Lord going to do? But the Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 56, as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them in the hellfire, and as often as the skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. If Hitler killed 6 million Jews, Allah says he can put him into hellfire and give him fresh skin again. 6 million times Allah can burn him. Not here, in the year after, in the hell. So only way I can prevent Hitler from killing 6 million Jews is tell him that here you kill 6 million Jews, Allah will burn you 12 million times in the year after. You can't give him that thing here. What you realize, without the concept of hell and heaven, you cannot prove robbing is bad. You cannot prove raping is bad. That's the reason our Creator Almighty God, who has created the human beings, he tells us what is good, what is bad for us. And he tells us the rules and regulations. This is called as religion. So first you have to find out which book is the authentic book which has been revealed by this Almighty God. And when you do research, you will come to it, that is the Quran. All the scriptures speak about Almighty God, and all the scriptures, they point out to the last and final revelation, the Quran, and last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Hope that answers the question.
Thanks.
Do we have any more questions in the lady section?
Assalamu alaikum. I just want to tell Dr. Zakir, I am a revert, and I was just asking questions on behalf of my non-Muslim family and friends, and I just wanted to say, you know, subhanallah and la ilaha illallah.
Welcome to the religion of peace, sister. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you and grant you Jannah. And pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide you. And if you have any questions, sister, regarding to help your other family members come back to the right faith, to revert, you're most welcome to ask any questions, sister. And if you have any clarification, you're most welcome. There are many Dawah centers here in Dubai. There are many sisters' organizations. You can contact them, inshallah, if you have any queries. And now if you have any questions regarding to convince your other family members, you're most welcome to our sister.
Good evening, Dr. Zakir Naik. This is Mary. I'm a Christian and a banker by profession. My question for you is based on your statement that nowhere in the Bible it's mentioned that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And based on my knowledge and understanding of Bible, I have picked up two verses to quote, and I would like only your clarification in the light of Islam. The first one is Matthew chapter 3, verse number 17. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. The second is John chapter 3, verse number 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So whosoever shall believe in him
shall not die but have everlasting life.
Strike.
Sister, just to correct your statement, you made a question saying that I said that nowhere in the Bible it says that Jesus is Son of God. I never said that nowhere in the Bible is it mentioned that Jesus is Son of God. I said there is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible. There is not a single unambiguous statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, always says worship me. I never said the Bible does not say Jesus is Son of God. What I said, there is not a single unambiguous statement, not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, always worship me. If you point out any such two statements, I'm ready to accept Christianity. If your question assumes that Son of God means Jesus is God, very well, I'll reply to your question. Many Christians think that just by the statement Son of God means Jesus is God. Sister, do you know in the Bible, Adam is Son of God, Ephraim is Son of God, Israel is Son of God. God has got sons by the tons in the Bible. That means you haven't read your Bible, sister. So do you mean to say all of them are gods? Is Adam God? Is Ephraim God? Is Israel God? No. Son of God, sister, is a statement used if you read Romans chapter number 8, verse number 14. All those that are led by the Spirit of God, they are sons of God. Means if you follow the commandment of God, if I follow the commandment of God, I am a son of God. In this way, undoubtedly, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, verily is the most beloved Son of God. Meaning, he is following the commandment of God. I have got no problem at all. If you say Son of God means persons who follow the commandments of God, like it's mentioned in Romans, all those who are led by the Spirit of God, they are sons of God. If I follow the commandment of God, you follow the commandment of God, we are called children of God. Very innocent statement, no problem. So as far as your Matthew is concerned, 3:17, I've clarified. Now coming to your second quotation of Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse number 16. But what the Christian missionaries say? No, 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 Brother Zakir. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is not a normal son. He is the begotten Son of God. And they quote Gospel of John, chapter number 3, verse number 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believeth in him shall not die, but have everlasting life. Sister, simple question. What is the meaning of the word begotten?
He has given it?
No, what is the meaning of begotten?
He has given his son to the people.
No, no, sister. Begotten doesn't mean he's given his son. You know English, I know English. Your English is, mashallah, very good. Begotten doesn't mean he's given his son. If I say you have begotten a son.
Sorry to interrupt.
Don't give metaphorical meaning. English.
I'm not a scholar.
You're not a scholar, but your English is very good.
I'm a layman person.
But sister, your English is very. If I say you have begotten a son, what does it mean? That means you have had sexual relationship with your husband and you begot a son. Begetting is a function of lower animals of sex. How can I attribute this function to Almighty God? Who did God have sex with? Who? That's the reason the scholars of Christianity, if you read the Revised Standard Edition, Revised Standard Version of the Bible, revised by 32 scholars, Christian scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 different corporate denominations, they say this word begotten in Gospel of John, chapter number 3, verse number 16, is an interpolation, is a fabrication, is a concoction, and they're thrown out of the Bible. So if you read the Bible, if you read the Revised Standard Version, it is the bestseller in the world. Revised Standard Version, revised by not Muslims, not Hindus, 32 Christian scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 different corporate denominations, they say this word begotten is not present in the original manuscript of Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 16. What they say, it's an interpolation, it's a fabrication, it's a concoction, it's an adulteration. So Jesus is just like a son, like Adam was son of God, Ephraim was son of God, Israel was son of God, he's a prophet of God. So I've got no problem in accepting that verily Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was a prophet and a messenger of God, but he was not God. Hope that answers the question, sister. So now, sister.
Thank you very much, Dr.
Sister, can we reverse the role now?
Yes,
I said I was ready to accept Christianity if you prove Jesus was God. Would you accept Islam now? Would you agree that Jesus is a prophet of God?
I have still a few more things to clarify.
You're most welcome, sister.
Why do Muslims refrain from the statement, Son of God? Why?
Yes. If I answer the question, will you accept Islam? Well, it's not a compulsion.
I think we have a huge population of Muslims in the world. We need believers. We do not need only Muslims by name.
Yes, so we want Muslim by deed. So we want to become Muslim by deed, not by name. Sister, okay, coming to your question, that why do Muslims refrain from using Son of God as a phrase? Very good question. And that's the reason, sister, if you read the Quran, Quran has got 99 attributes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Hakim, most gracious, most merciful, most wise. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his last and final revelation, if there's something like Old Testament and New Testament, Quran is the last testament. In his last testament, he has not used the word Ab. In Arabic, Ab means father. Why? He has used the more difficult word, Rab. Rab is more difficult to pronounce than Ab, which means the Lord, the Cherisher, the Sustainer. He has used Rab as attribute, but not Ab. Why? Because in the previous revelation which were changed, Bible is the changed form of the Injil. People have misunderstood the meaning of Son of God. They started thinking to be begotten Son. For example, if I tell, you know, young son, beta, tumne achcha sawal pucha. You know, son, you have asked a very good question. If a son asked a question of the age of 10, son, you have asked a very good question. But if I say, you begotten son, you have asked a very good question, he may punch me. He will not say, oh, Zakir is elderly, he may punch me. That means I'm abusing his mother. If I say, my begotten son, he'll get angry. I'm insinuating that I had sex with his mother. So son is innocent word, begotten son is not innocent. Same way, the son is a very good word, but people started misunderstanding. So to remove this confusion, that's the reason the Quran does not use the word father as attribute to Almighty God. Otherwise, it's a good word. So same way, we refrain from using Son of God because people start thinking that he's God. No Christian ever comes and tells me, Adam is son of God, Ephraim is son of God. Why? Bible says Israel is son of God. Why don't you come and tell me? Because they are programmed. No Christian has come and told me that the Bible says Ephraim is son of God. No, why? Because they're programmed to believe that Jesus Christ is Almighty God. He never said he's Almighty God. And I told you earlier, in my earlier answer, he never claimed divinity. That means you're insulting Almighty God. That means you're insulting Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. That's what I say. If Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, we Muslims are more Christian than the Christian themselves. You know why? Because if you read the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, he was circumcised on the eighth day. We Muslims are circumcised, Christians are uncircumcised. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said that you have to follow each and every law of the Bible, each and every commandment, Gospel of Matthew chapter 5, verse number 17 to 20. If you break one law or jittle from the commandment, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. If you go to the Old Testament, it clearly says in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 11, verse number 7 to 8. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 8. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 65, verse number 2 to 5, that you shall not have pork. Muslims don't have pork, but Christians have pork. So if Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, we Muslims are more Christian than the Christians themselves. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 5, verse number 18, that thou shalt not have wine. It's mentioned in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 20, verse number 1. Wine is a mocker. You should not have wine. Muslims don't have alcohol, but the Christians have alcohol. Further, if you analyze, there are various references I can give you. So if Christian means one who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, I say that I am more Christian than the Christian themselves. If you become a Muslim, you are a more better practicing Christian than the so-called namesake Christians. Yes, sister.
Can I ask something?
Sure, yeah. Right. You're most welcome, sister.
I would not like to cross-question or criticize your statement.
Sister, you're most welcome to cross-question me. You're most welcome to criticize me. I love it. Unless a person doesn't cross-examine. See, suppose I want to prove something. If I say this is the best, I want to check it out whether it's best or not.
That's right.
Because a logical person, so please, sister, cross-examine me, criticize me, attack me. Once you're convinced, then you accept it. Yes, sister, go ahead.
I will definitely not intend to do something like this. The object of questioning more is to know more so that I know what I follow is right. That's all. Thank you very much.
Sister, you can ask any question, no problem. You're most welcome. Whether your intention is very good, but I went to the extent of saying even your intention is bad, no problem. But your intention is very good, sister. So you can ask any questions and you don't have to accept Islam. No one can force you. Quran says, La ikraha fid din. There's no compulsion in religion. Truth stands out clear from error. So don't think that if I answer your question, you have to accept. On the day of judgment, only give the evidence that I gave you the answer. Yes, sister, any questions?
Thank you very much.
Yes, sister.
You said that we Muslims are better Christians than the actual Christians. So
the complete statement I made, if Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, we Muslims are more Christian than the Christian themselves. Yes, sister, your question.
But this is not a layman statement. Do not have a specialized knowledge of Islam and as well as Christianity.
And you can ask the doctors of divinity whether I'm saying is right or wrong. Yes, sister.
Thank you very much, Dr. Zanang.
So what is the question that?
That was my question, that why did you mention that we Muslims are better Christians than the actual Christians?
When I said that, why did I say that?
I think this is beyond my thinking that why would a Muslim call himself a Christian?
No, correct. Why? Because we love Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We love him more than you. We love him, we respect him, we revere him, but we don't worship him. The reason I said this because I love Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. I respect him, I revere him, but I don't worship him. Because he never told me to worship him. If he would have told me to worship him, I would have worshipped him. So that's the reason I say, if Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, I'm more Christian than the Christian themselves. Because I love Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. I respect him, I revere him, but I don't worship him. So hope that answers the question, sister.
Thank you very much.
Is there any more questions? Here, over here in the front.
Went to heaven or hell? Like, how we can feel this guy went to heaven, this guy went to hell. And if it is there anybody seen or felt is went to heaven, he went to, like, the other will see and come to know, yes, he went to heaven, he made mistakes. He went to hell, he made, he went to heaven, he made good thing, and he went to heaven.
Well, that's the question, that is there any signs when a person dies, we come to know whether he's going to heaven or hell? Normally, we don't know, because we are not the judge. We don't know the inside out of a human being. Do you know what a human being thinking in his mind? Do you know what I'm thinking in my heart? So that's the reason we cannot be the judge. The best person is the person who is the master of the day of judgment, that is our Creator Almighty God.
My question is, is the judgment happen on that time to that guy? That means he passed away, he's not alive, he's gone. Though the next that time is the judgment for him. Are we able to see, or can I cannot say that many physical changes might be hands or eyes or something else which is specialized, especially we can notice.
Brother, someone appears for the test. Suppose there are 100 students, you are one of the students, correct? Now, when you stay for the full year, you come to know this student is intelligent, this student is average, this student is weak. So you being one of the students and 100 students, you can make an assumption. This student will come out first class first, correct? This student will get second class. That student will fail, correct? Can you make or not?
Yes.
Can you make an assumption? Why? Because they have lived for one full year with your colleagues.
He write exam, he get passes.
Wait. Can you make an assumption?
Not at all.
Assumption that this student will come out first class first because he answers very well.
It's not possible.
I'm not asking you judgment. Can you make assumption means, can
assumption
you, assumption you can make
you can,
or not?
You can assume something.
Yes. Why? Because that student always answers. Whenever teacher asks a question, that student answers. So hopefully he will come out first. You can make an assumption, correct?
Yeah.
One student average, one student never answers, fail. Assumption. He writes an examination. You assume, he will come out first. But the teacher hasn't corrected. Without teacher correcting, he has come out first. Can you say that? No. You can assume this person will come out first. So after a person dies, it's like a person has given the examination. But until the results are out, you cannot say for sure he has come out first. You can assume. If I ask you how many marks you got, can you say? No. You can assume he'll come out first. Can you tell me the exact number of marks he has got out of 100? Can you?
Nobody.
No. What you can say? He'll come out first. You know, may get 90, 92, 95, but you cannot say exactly. Why? Because the results aren't out. Similarly, when a person dies, by looking at his deeds, you can assume this is a good human being. He did not rob, he believed in one God. He did not associate partners with God. Inshallah, he will go to heaven. This person, oh, he used to rob, he used to cheat, he never believed in God, he did idol worship, he will go to hell. But real result will come to know after the day of judgment when the result's out. So the Quran says that Almighty God is the master of the day of judgment. All the human beings who have died, they will be raised up again on the day of judgment. Right from the first human being, Adam, peace be upon him, till the last human being. All will be resurrected together and then will the judgment be given. So what you assume may be right, may be wrong. The exact marks is, therefore when a person dies, you can assume, God willing, inshallah, he will go to heaven. God willing, inshallah, this person, you know, used to do shirk, he used to associate partners, he used to rob, he used to rape, he used to cheat, he will go to heaven. You can assume. Similarly, if God wants to forgive someone, shirk he will never forgive. Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 48, Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 116, if Allah pleases, he may forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk he will never forgive. If you associate partners with God, if you do idol worship, God will never forgive you. So I as a person can only say 100% a person will go to hell as if he has done shirk. If he dies as a mushrik, if he dies associating partners with God and not believing in one God alone, then I can say for sure he will go to hell. All the other human beings, if he does some sin, if Almighty God wants to forgive him, he may forgive him, but we don't know now. We'll only come to know the day of judgment. Hope that answers the question.
May we move to the ladies section. Are there any more non-Muslim ladies who have a question? Please go ahead.
Good evening, doctor. My name is Rose, telephone operator. As a Christian, I believe that Jesus was created by God, our creator, and was born through miracle. One of my friends, he is a Muslim, and he requested me to read the Holy Quran, and I got interest of it. And I found out when I read it that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. And my question is, how Muhammad he was born? Is it through miracle also?
Sister asked a very good question. She says she's a Christian, she's a telephone operator, and she knows that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was created by God. Perfectly right. He was born miraculously by the help of God. Perfectly right. When she read the Quran, she came to know that Muhammad is the messenger of God, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She's asking, how was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam born? Sister, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born naturally. He had a mother and father. He was born naturally. He was not born miraculously. But if someone tries to say that because Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, had no father, therefore he's Almighty God, if this is your understanding, that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, had a mother and father. Jesus Christ had a mother but no father. So if that makes him a God, then the reply is given in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 59. Inna masala Isa indallahi ka masala Adam. Khalaqa min turab summa qala lahu kun fayakun. The similitude of Jesus in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like Adam. He was created from dust and said, be, and it was. If you say that Jesus is God because he has no father, then Adam, peace be upon him, is a greater God. He had no mother and no father. MashaAllah.
All I can promise is I will continue to read the Holy Quran so that I will learn more.
And we're waiting for you to come to the religion of peace, sister. You read the
Thank
Quran.
Thank you very much.
And the moment you understand that Islam is the right way of life, if you believe in the Quran, immediately you should accept it. Accept there's no God but Allah, and believe that Jesus is a messenger of God and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the messenger of God. If you believe Jesus is a messenger of God, and if you believe in one God who has got no images, and you believe Prophet Muhammad is the last messenger who was prophesied in the Bible, as I mentioned, then you become a Muslim. The moment you believe that God is one, and Jesus is a messenger, peace be upon him, and Prophet Muhammad is the last messenger, then you submit your will to Almighty God. So do you believe?
I do believe that we have only one God. We are all brothers and sisters.
Correct. But do you believe that Jesus is the messenger of God?
Yes.
Do you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
I've come to know when I read the Holy Quran.
But do you believe in it?
I believe.
So if you believe...
I will become to believe.
Sorry?
I will believe and I will come to believe. I will open my heart to believe what is the Quran is.
So do you believe that Muhammad is the messenger of God?
I'm learning to believe. I am accepting.
MashaAllah, if you're accepting, practice comes later on. First you have to accept.
That's why I promise you that I will learn and I will read more about Quran.
Yes, but after
so that I will know the whole truth.
Sister, but when you read and when you believe, you have to accept. Once you accept, then you put into practice.
It doesn't I will understand come, you, it also.
Yes, you have to read, you have to understand. And the moment you realize the truth that Almighty God is one, He has got no images, He is not begotten, Jesus is a messenger of God. And if you agree, Prophet Muhammad is a messenger of God, that means in Arabic we say Muslim. Muslim means a person who submits his will to God. The practice comes later on. Practice then fine, you may have to pray, you may have to fast. But one thing is first you have to accept. As you said that we are believers. Believers means you believe there's one God and you submit your will to God, then you're called as a Muslim. So hope you believe in Almighty
Inshallah.
God. And do you believe in Prophet Muhammad as a messenger of God?
I cannot promise.
Okay, fine.
But
at least
I will try my very level best.
Yes, you try, and inshallah, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may give you that, may give you guidance.
Thank you very much.
The gentleman in front.
My name is Shadi Isa. I am TV director, producer. I'm Christian. I want to tell you something that I know Quran, and I had read Quran many times. And exactly I know how Quran describes Holy Mary through the Surah Maryam and Surah Al-Imran. Okay? I'll ask you something. I watch many times a session like this. The purpose all the time is to show the difference between Muslim and Christian. My question is, why we don't make a session like this and invite people like those to talk about the comments between being Christian and being Muslim? I believe in God and believe in Jesus and believe in Muhammad, everything. But I don't believe to make different between being Muslim and being Christian.
Well, that's a good question. He said in this session, we are trying to make differences. We should try and make similarities. Brother, last time when the Dubai International Holy Quran Award called me, 4 years back, the topic of my talk was similarities between Islam and Christianity. Today.
But should I, do I need to be Muslim to believe in God?
I will tell you that. That's a new question. First, I'll answer your first question and come to your second question. You said that in this session we talk about differences. Brother, was I talking differences or was I talking about similarities now? Didn't I say I'm more Christian than the Christian themselves? I said, Jesus Christ said, don't have alcohol. I don't have alcohol. I'm talking about similarities. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, follow the earlier law, don't have pork. I don't have pork. You all have pork. I'm talking about similarities or differences? I'm talking about similarities. I told that Hindu that your scripture says Almighty God has got no images. Almighty God has got no images. I'm trying to bring similarities in his scripture and my scripture. Now, because of his ignorance, he is not aware what his scripture says. Suppose someone says, 2 plus 2 is equal to 5. I said, brother, 2 plus 2 is not 5, 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. It's mentioned in your book also and my book also. So I'm trying to get the similarities. If a person doesn't understand maths clearly, I try and explain to him maths because I'm a student of comparative religion. So what I'm talking here is similarity, not the differences. I can give a bigger talk on differences. Coming to your second question, what did you say?
Do I need to be Muslim?
Ah, very good, very good, very good question. He said, I believe in God. Do I have to become a Muslim? Brother, if you believe in God, what is the meaning of Muslim? Muslim does not mean Zakir, Sultan, Abdullah, Shakir. Muslim doesn't mean Muslim name. You can keep your name Isa also, no problem. Muslim means submitting your will to God. Now you say, I believe in God, but I don't submit my will to God. That means you're a hypocrite. So Muslim means person who submits his will to God. So if I translate your question, I believe in God, do I have to be a Muslim? In English it is, I believe in God, do I have to submit your will to God? I said, yeah, if you believe in God, you have to submit your will to God. If you don't submit your will to God, that means you're a hypocrite, correct? That's what in Arabic. Muslim means a person who submits his will to God. You ask me the question, I believe in God, do I have to be a Muslim? It means, I believe in God, do I have to submit my will to God? Of course you have to. If you don't submit your will to God, That means you don't believe in God.
I am Christian. I believe in God. I don't need to be Muslim to believe in God.
Brother, what is the meaning of the word Muslim?
What?
What is the meaning of the word Muslim?
He is Muslim.
Did you hear my answer? The problem is you are asking a question.
What I mean?
Brother, did you hear my answer? My answer was, Muslim by definition means a person who submits his will to God. Just by keeping the name Shakir, Sultan, Zakir, Muhammad, Abdullah, you don't become a Muslim. Muslim means a person who submits his will to God. What is the meaning of Muslim? Repeat.
Okay, please.
Person who submits his will to God. Now you asking me, I believe in God. Do I have to submit my will to God? Of course you have to. That means you don't know the meaning of the word Muslim. Now because you don't, I'm explaining to you. If you believe in God, you have to submit your will to God. You have to try and find out who is the true God. What did God tell you? And you have to submit your will to God. If you don't submit your will to God, that means you don't believe in God.
Okay.
Okay, so now you believe in God.
Thank you.
You're most welcome.
Are there any more questions in the middle lane? Please.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Prabhakaran. I'm working as a supervisor. Firstly, I would like to know, there is a common saying in most of the religions that whoever follows God's sayings religiously will go to heaven, and if not, will go to hell. Taking this into consideration, I would like to know what will be the status of non-Muslims on the Day of Judgment. Secondly, I would like to know the importance of the holy month of Ramadan for the benefit of non-Muslims who have come here. And finally, I would like to say, from the little experience I have gained in my life, I can strongly say Islam is the only religion which has clear-cut, sound theoretical knowledge supported with logical examples with reasoning.
The brother asked three questions or three statements he had made. The first question was that all the religions say that if you don't believe in the commandments of God, you will go to hell. What will happen to non-Muslim on the Day of Judgment? Brother, as I mentioned earlier, the Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse 48, and Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse 116, Allah, if He pleases, He may forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk, associating partners with God, He'll never forgive. So if a person dies as a non-Muslim, and he associates partners with others, he believes in false gods, he does idol worship, he shall never go to heaven. Compulsory, he'll go to hell. To go to heaven, you have to believe in one God, worship Him alone, and follow His commandments. Regarding a second question, what is the benefit of the month of Ramadan to the non-Muslims? Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 83, fasting has been prescribed to you as it was prescribed to people who came before you so that you may learn self-restraint. The reason we fast is because we increase our taqwa, our God consciousness, our piety. And Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse 185 says, Ramadan was the month in which the Quran was revealed as a guidance to the whole of humanity, as a criteria to judge right from wrong. Ramadan is this month in which the glorious Quran, the last and final revelation, was revealed to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And the Quran says, this Quran is a guidance for humanity, not only for Muslims or for the Arabs, for the whole of humanity. And it is a criteria to judge right from wrong. So this month of Ramadan, how does it benefit the non-Muslims? Quran was revealed in it as a guidance for whole of humanity, Muslims and non-Muslims. Furthermore, beloved Prophet Muhammad said, Ramadan is the month in which the Satans, they are imprisoned. The gates of heaven are open and the gates of hell are closed. That means there are more chances you'll do good deeds. A person does more good deeds in Ramadan, the chances of him doing bad deeds is less. As far as non-Muslims, the message of Islam may go very well in the hearts of the non-Muslims because the devil, the Satan, the imprisonment. So more chances of the non-Muslims accepting Islam, more chances he'll come closer to Islam. Regarding a third statement, you believe that Islam has got theoretical points in it and it is backed up with reason and logic. So when you agree that Islam then rules and regulations which are backed up with reason and logic, my question to you in this month of Ramadan, then why don't you accept Islam?
It is not a question of accepting Islam. For the matter of fact, I do accept all the religions, all the good things every religion is saying. So I don't have any...
Brother, you say you believe in all the good things in all the religions. That means there are some bad things in some religions, correct?
I do agree. Strongly agree.
Okay, fine. I want to ask you a simple question. What do you think is bad in Islam?
Practically, I have not come across anything bad in Islam, but maybe in practice, people have...
No, in Islam, don't talk about Muslim. Muslim may be bad. I'm not talking about Muslims.
Okay.
Talk about Islam. There are Muslims who may have alcohol, there are Muslims who may cheat.
I've not come across anything
very
bad about
good,
Islam.
Very good.
To be
now,
very frank.
Now, you told me very frankly, you take good things of all the religions. You also said you know there are bad things in other religions. And you also said you don't know of anything bad in Islam. So
yeah,
now in the other religions, there are good and bad. In this religion, only good. Suppose I give you two glasses of water. One is pure water. Other water, pure water, and one drop of urine. So which water will you drink?
Good water, of course.
Good, pure water. So this is a pure religion. Absolutely pure, without adulteration. Now, when I realize it is pure, when you are thirsty, you'll drink the pure water. No, I believe it is pure, but I won't drink it. It doesn't make sense. If I want to get admission in a university, I do my survey. This university is the best. Why don't you take admission? No, I'll think about it. If you don't have the money to pay your fees, fine. University is very good, but too expensive. I can't afford the fees. Islam is free. If you agree it's the best, you have to accept it. Or maybe it's a hypocrisy. See, if I agree it's the best, I have to accept it. If you know there are no faults, that means God will question you on the day of judgment. If you agree, God gave you the message in your heart, it is the best religion, why don't you accept it? See, if you agree it is the best, it's illogical. It's illogical not to accept it. If you think there's something bad, I will clarify your misconception now. If you agree it's the best religion, if you agree it's the most logical, unless you are illogical. If you are logical, you have to agree the most logical religion. Unless you consider yourself to be illogical, brother. You know, sometimes, brother, emotions. What will my mother say? What will my father say? What will society say? Muslim! So these things may prevent you from accepting. I agree. It's difficult. It's not easy, brother. But if you are logical, if you are scientific, you have to accept what is best. Therefore, I say, if someone proves to me any religion better than Islam, I will accept it. If someone proves to me today, anytime, there's any religion better than Islam, I am ready to accept. If someone proves to me Christianity is better, I am ready to accept Christianity. Someone proves to me Hinduism is better, I am ready to accept Hinduism. I am not just talking. I have discussions with the doctors of divinity, with the top Christians. I am not a scholar, I am a student. I consider myself to be a student of comparative religion. But I have dialogues and discussions and debates with the top scholars of Hinduism. You know, the most popular Hindu speaker is Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. Yeah. Have you heard of him?
Very much.
Yes, he agreed with the Quran.
I'm a big fan of him, in fact.
You're a fan of him, mashallah. Have you seen my debate with Sri Sri Ravi Shankar?
No, I've not seen.
So you should see the debate with your hero,
yeah,
Sri Sri Ravi Shankar,
sure,
and the student of comparative religion.
Inshallah, if I get an opportunity, definitely.
Yes, and since you agree, even he agreed that God has got no images. He agreed in the truthfulness of the Quran. Unfortunately, he didn't accept it. You know why? If he accepts, he will lose all the following.
I agree.
You agree. Do you have a following? Do you have a following, brother?
No, I don't have any following.
Very good. So what will you lose? Maybe some friendship. Maybe some relatives. It's difficult. It's difficult. But if you know the truth, you should accept it. There's nothing wrong about it.
Actually, so far as of now, I have not thought of about this because this is the very toughest and hardest thing in life to me.
Think today in the month of Ramadan. You ask me, how does it benefit non-Muslims? It benefits a non-Muslim in opening the heart towards the truth. So I request you to think it over. If not today, yet you have another 3 weeks. Another 2-3 weeks you have till the month of Ramadan. If not today, except in the month of Ramadan, it will benefit you. And inshallah, I can tell you that inshallah, if you accept Islam, all your previous sins will be forgiven. 100%. So today, if you accept Islam, if suppose you die today, I can tell for sure, you will go to Jannah. I'm not sure about myself, but about yourself, I can tell you. Because the moment a person accepts Islam, all his previous sins are forgiven. If you accept Islam and if something happens to you today, I don't know about others. Inshallah, you'll go to Jannah.
Thank you very much.
So I'm waiting for acceptance, brother.
Is there any more questions? Here, over here, in the front.
I wanted to know about the Kaaba. I had a question about the Kaaba. I mean, what is its significance scientifically and logically? And why do Muslims circle around the Kaaba?
Brother asked a very good question. that what is the significance of Kaaba scientifically, logically, and why do Muslims circumambulate on the Kaaba? Now, many non-Muslims think that we Muslims worship the Kaaba. It is? That's wrong, correct. I'll give that answer and even come to a scientific answer. I will club both together to answer you and the other non-Muslim misconception. The thing is that Kaaba is the Qibla. The Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 144, that wherever you are, pray in the direction of the Kaaba. In Arabic, direction means Qibla. So Kaaba is only for direction. For example, today if you have to pray here, some will say left face south, some will say north, some will say east, some will say west. Maybe do you face? So for unity, we face towards one direction, Kaaba. So Kaaba is our Qibla. No Muslim ever worships the Kaaba. And when the world map of geography was drawn the first time, it was the Muslims who drew the world map first. It was Al-Idrusi in the year 1154 who drew the world map. And when the Muslims drew the world map, they had South Pole on top, North Pole down, and the Kaaba in the center. Later on, the Western cartographers came and they turned the map upside down, North Pole top, South Pole down, yet the Kaaba is in the center. So whichever part of the world you are, if you are staying in the north, you face towards the south. If you are in the east, you face towards the west. If you are in the west, you face towards the east. If you are in the south, you face towards the north. All Muslims throughout the world, they face in one direction, Kaaba. Kaaba is the Qibla. Now when we go for Umrah, or when we go for Hajj, we do tawaf around the Kaaba, we circumambulate. Why do we circumambulate? Basically because of our God creator, because Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said we did it. You ask me logically what's the reason, though it's not mentioned in the Quran or Hadith. If I as a logical person want to think, why do we circumambulate? The reason I can think is, every circle has got one center. We circumambulate around the Kaaba to testify there is one God. Because circle has got only one center, doesn't have two center. We circumambulate to testify there is one God. And the statement of Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, the second Khalifa of Islam, which is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of Hajj, chapter number 56, Hadith number 675. The second Khalifa of Islam, Hazrat Umar, said, this black stone, pointing at the Hajar Aswad, the black stone in the Kaaba, this black stone can neither benefit me, can neither harm me. I'm kissing it only because my Prophet kissed it. This statement proves that no Muslim ever worships the Kaaba. Furthermore, at the time of the Prophet Muhammad, there were Sahabas who stood on the Kaaba and gave the Azan. No idol worshipper will ever stand on the idol he or she worships. So this proves that the Muslims don't worship the Kaaba. Kaaba is only the Qibla, it's only a direction. Hope that answers the question.
Do we have any more questions in the middle line?
Are there non-Muslims like to ask a question? Any of the microphones? Any non-Muslim like to ask a question, then come on the microphone, they're most welcome. Anyone in that queue? Any non-Muslims? Any non-Muslim like to ask a second time also, they're most welcome. Till the time the non-Muslims come on the microphone, we can take questions from the Muslims. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum, brother Jakir. I'm working for Burj Dubai for hotel. But actually, I'm always thinking for hotel working is halal or haram. That is the biggest hotel for in Dubai. But always I'm thinking for the, and I'm long time is working for the hotel industry. And please you can, thank
brother,
you.
Brother, the question, I work for a hotel, working in hotel haram or halal. If the activities in the hotel are halal, it's allowed. If the activities are haram, it's not allowed. See, if you tell me the name of the... See,
so I'm clear for the hotel, but you know the hotel industry is working for the... There is hard drinks and soft drinks,
whatever. Hard drink and soft drink.
And not
yeah.
only this, like not that, only nah. this, not only... Stay, I'm
working in a five-star for, hotel.
No,
allowed
yes, five-star hotel. And
allowed or not? Okay, fine. I know most of the five-star hotels have got alcohol. So working...
And I'm clearly, please, sir. Actually, all the five-star hotel, I'm never included, but my hotel is... It's hard drinks.
Hard drinks. Five-star hotel.
Supplying is some sector, but
what
I'm
is
not.
Position? What's
I'm
your position?
Sorry, sir. I'm not working for the hard drink sector. I'm working the front office.
Front but, office. Oh, front but, office. Yeah, that's better.
That's why I'm say, always thinking.
Is fine. Now the brother asks, if you're working in a hotel industry which serves alcohol, if you're serving alcohol yourself, it is haram to work there. But if you're working in any other sector which is not involved in haram activity, front desk can have haram also. Because I'm told, you know, front desk, If you see to the hotel, you know, we say that family hotel, you know. So if it's a non-family hotel, working in front desk also may become haram. So if it's a family hotel where everything is clean and all, you're working in the front desk, if there's alcohol served in a five-star hotel, the alcohol income is a small percentage. The alcohol income in the hotel is a small percentage, maybe less than 5%. If you're working in the front desk and yes. You're not involved in serving alcohol, not involved in any haram activities,
yes,
working is no problem.
I'm not served
then
alcohol.
Working there is no problem. You think your income is coming from a halal portion because the alcohol may be less than 5%. Think your portion is from the halal. You told me all five-star hotels serve alcohol. I disagree with you. Last time when I came to Dubai 4 months back, I was the guest of Jamal Majid and he kept it in his hotel Taj. And I'm told that the first five-star hotel in Dubai which does not serve alcohol. So don't tell me all the five-star hotels have alcohol. I've stayed in Taj. I was the guest of Jamal Majid last time when I came 4 months back. And I'm told initially the Taj group, you know, Taj belongs to Indians, to Tata, Ratan Tata. They objected. No. No alcohol means no Taj. They said, no alcohol means we don't want Taj. You want to come as our partner, we don't want alcohol. You want to come, come, otherwise don't come. The Taj were forced to agree with the request of Shah Jamal Majid. MashaAllah, and now I'm told it is one of the most expensive, most wanted hotel without alcohol, alhamdulillah. So don't tell me all the hotels, I do agree, almost all the hotels outside Saudi Arabia or those countries where alcohol is banned, they do have alcohol. But if you are the owner, you can very well put your foot down. And believe me, he's doing better business than most of the other five-star hotels. So you do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah gives you business. So coming back to your question, if you are not involved in any haram activity, if you are working in the other section of the hotel industry, and the hotel industry, the haram portion, is a small percentage, you think your income is from the halal portion. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you, sir.
May we move on to the sisters, please? If there are any more questions.
Assalamu alaikum again. This is Haifa and I'm a business student. My question is it permissible for a Muslim lady to make public talks for dawah if she wears hijab? If no, what are the other options? Thank you.
Sister asked a question that is permissible for a Muslim woman to give dawah in public talks with wearing hijab. As far as giving public talks in front of ladies only, no problem. My wife, mashallah, she's a dai. She is giving lectures in hundreds and thousands of ladies in many parts of the world. In Saudi Arabia, she has given talks in Dubai, in USA, in Canada, in many countries. So if a lady gives a talk in public in where there is only ladies, no problem. As far as a lady giving public talk in mixed gathering, there's difference of opinion. Difference of opinion. Though there are some scholars who say that fine, a lady can come on the stage, like on this stage in a mixed gathering. But those scholars who are more closer to Quran and Sunnah, they say a lady cannot give talk in mixed gathering. And I agree with the second group of scholars. Why? Because the Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 30, say to the believing man that he should lower his gaze and guard his modesty. Whenever a man looks at a woman, any brazen thought comes in his mind, he should lower his gaze. So if a woman is giving a talk in public, and if the men are watching, they should lower the gaze. If someone tells me, I look at a woman and nothing happens to him, then he requires a psychiatrist. If a man is giving a lecture, there are women looking at me. The next verse, the verse I quoted was Surah Nur, chapter 24, verse number 30, say to the believing man, you should lower his gaze and guard his modesty. Next verse, Surah Nur, chapter 24, verse number 31 says, say to the believing woman, that she should lower again and guard her modesty, same thing. But today scientific research tells me that when a man looks at a woman, his pupil dilates more as compared to a woman when she looks at a man. A man is sexually more aroused when he looks at a woman than a woman when he looks at a man. That's the reason today in schools which are single sex, the results are better. It is better for a man teaching mixed gathering. It's preferable for a man teaching a woman, a man teacher teaching a woman audience than a woman teacher teaching a man audience. Scientific research. In spite of that, if any woman looking at a dai, including me, If some unashamed thought comes, women should lower your gaze. But a woman is less excited as compared to a man. That's the reason I agree with the second group of scholars who say for women to give lectures in mixed gatherings, it's not permissible. That's the reason on our Peach TV, when we show a lady, we don't show more than 3 seconds. I mean, there's no mention in the Hadith and Quran, why 3 seconds, why not two, why not five? It is our ijtihad. Even though they're modestly dressed, maximum we show is for 3 seconds, so that it does not let the gents get excited. So sister, I agree with the second group of scholars. How should they do dawah? It is not compulsory for a man or woman to come on the stage to dawah. Sister, you can do dawah on the internet, you can do email, you can do dawah writing books, no problem. While doing dawah, preferable man does to a man, woman to a woman, male to male, female to female. In some countries I go, a man, a Muslim, dai, talking to a non-Muslim girl in closed doors, doing dawah. Her beloved Prophet Muhammad said, Namaram, man and a woman alone in a closed room, the third person is the devil. Even I cannot do dawah to a woman one-to-one, no. We have our dawah center in IRF, Islamic Research Foundation. We have a gents wing doing one-to-one dawah to gents, ladies one-to-one ladies. If there is some great problem where a lady cannot be convinced, and if I have to speak to a lady, it is with my mahram. Either my wife is there with me, or my sister is with me, or that lady's husband is there, or brother is there, with lowering the gaze. This is Islam. So we should follow the rules and regulations. Do dawah, but within the purview of the Islamic Sharia. The woman, we have got great scope. In Bombay, the women do one-to-one dawah more than the gents. In our Bombay branch, there are more ladies accepting Islam than the gents. So mashallah, in IRF, mashallah, they have so many sessions. They have marriage preparatory course, they have Ramadan month, they have the Quran Fahmi, so many sessions they have. 1 day workshop, 3 day workshop, 1 week workshop. They have lectures and hundreds and thousands of ladies attend. Mashallah. But it should be females with females and gents with gents. Hope that answers the question.
May we move to the first?
Assalamu alaikum to everybody. My question to Brother Zakir Naik is regarding dawah to a special Hindu friend of mine. She has been suffering from psoriasis vulgaris since childhood, and she does not understand why God is punishing or examining her for no fault of her own. And because of this, I have not been able to carry forward dawah because she comes and stops on this regard. Can you give me a logical explanation?
Brother asked the question that while doing dawah to a non-Muslim girl, she's suffering from psoriasis and she doesn't know why God is punishing. What is the reason? Brother, first thing you should say, when any calamity befalls on a person, it's either a punishment or a test. When any good things happen to any person, it's either a reward or a test. Many people who are non-Muslims, they're very rich. So that's not a reward, it's a test for them. Similarly for her, any calamity comes, it's either a punishment or a test. If she feels she has not done any sin, then it's a test for her. Testing that does she have faith in God after having the disease. A good mu'min. There is a statement that says that I used to always complain because I had no footwear, I had no shoes. I used to always complain because I had no shoes until I saw a man who had no feet. You understand? We are complaining, God, I've got no shoes, no shoes. When he saw a man with no feet, thank God, at least I have feet. Only psoriasis is a disease which is fine, nothing great. There are other people who have AIDS. Other people have major diseases which are detrimental to life. Psoriasis is not that. So therefore, look at the people below you, then thank God that he has at least blessed me with this life. So tell her, it's a test for her. She has only a small disease. There are people who have multiple times more disease, cancer, terminal illness, AIDS. She should thank God that she has no cancer. She should thank God that she doesn't have AIDS. She should thank God that she doesn't have disease which are incurable. So this is a test for her. Hope that answers the question. Inshallah, we'll just take one last question from each microphone before we end the session. So we'll just take one last question from each of the microphone before we end the session. Yes, brother.
I am Muhammad Babaruddin, I'm a Siddiqui. I'm software engineer by profession. However, I have several non-Muslim friends in my community. They usually told me that you people are hypocrites, as you are living in this interest-based economic system, and each currency even is affected by this interest. How do I reply to him that we are not involved in this? Even I have a current account in my bank.
Brother said that one of the non-Muslims is saying you Muslims are hypocrites, you are dealing in interest, etc. How can he convince? Brother, there are Muslims who own bank, but tell him that the major banks, it's owned by the Jews. And all the banks have got security, finally it goes to the Federal Bank. You know, Federal Bank in US. And Federal Bank in US is not owned by the US government. Many people think that the Federal Bank is owned by the government of US. No. It is owned by 7 individual families, and all of them are Jews. JP Morgan, Rockefeller, all of them. So your friend doesn't know the banking system. He doesn't know that how it is controlled by the Jews. So the full world, interest-based banking is controlled by the Jews. But I do know that there are some Muslims who own banks, interest-based banks, which is wrong. It's haram. Tell him that the Quran says about riba in no less than 8 different places. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 278 and 279, if you do not abstain from involving in riba, in interest, take notice of a war from Allah and His Rasul. If you deal in interest, whether take interest or give interest, the Quran says Allah and His Rasul will wage a war against you. Interest is one of the major sins in Islam. If you have alcohol, it's a major sin, but Allah and His Rasul will not wage a war against you. When someone has alcohol, you say, oh, alcohol, very bad Muslim. Someone take interest, no problem, society is there. Taking interest and giving interest is the bigger sin than drinking alcohol, according to the Quran. So, we should abstain from interest. That's the reason Quran is against riba. Hope that answers the question. Wa akhiru da'wan, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen.
Actually, we want to vote our thanks on behalf of Dubai International Holy Quran Awards and the organizing committee of these lectures. First, I would like to thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for helping us in conducting this program successfully. We are also grateful to Our Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, the ruler of Dubai, and the Dubai Holy Quran Award for inviting Dr. Zakir Naik again to Dubai. Our sincere thanks goes to the officials at Dubai World Trade Center and Airport Expo, and our many thanks to the Road and Transport Authority and Dubai Municipality. Vendors, contractors and suppliers also need our special thanks. Our crew members and technical team of Peace TV, ladies and gents, volunteers who worked round the clock to organize the session and made sure the proceedings went smooth. And last but not least, dear friends and guests, who have accepted our invitations and came from near and far of places to make our efforts fruitful and benefit from what we have learned today. Thank you very much. Jazakallahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum.